Hello, everyone. Hi. I'm Jennifer Green. I'm the Chief Learning Officer with Catamount Medical Education. You may have seen lots of communication from us. We work with the Consortium of Multiple Sclerosis Centers to put together this program for you this afternoon. I want to welcome all the participants that we have here in Orlando, as well as the participants that we have joining us virtually. So it's going to be an exciting and amazing day. For those of you who are joining us virtually, I just want you to know that you can actually access the slides that we're presenting here, and you can access the virtual exhibit hall. You can do that just on the platform itself. And for those of you who are joining us here live in Orlando, we provided all of the information, the slides and pertinent helpful information for you in the workbooks that you see on the table. I really encourage you to use those to make some notes. And we've also provided you with a USB drive, and that has all the information on there as well. So we hope that you take advantage of that. We would like to thank our very, very generous supporters who have provided us with the funding to be able to put on this program. We'd like to thank Biogen, Bristol-Myers Squibb, Genentech, Greenwich Biosciences, Mallinckrodt, and Novartis for their generous support. We could not do it without them. So we have some really fun interactivity planned during the program. So every once in a while, we'll sort of stop and do, you know, something a little bit fun. So I do want to just provide some brief instructions. I know that we've gone through and tried to help as many people as possible, but we do have two staff members here. As I go through this, I might be going through it a little bit quickly, who are able to help you if you would like to join in the interactivity. But you're still going to learn something anyway if you're not able to connect, so don't worry. We've got some great fun facts. So we have a QR code for those who are joining us live. We have a QR code on the table tents that you see there. So you can actually scan that with your camera, and it's going to give you a link that'll pop up, and you can click on that link, and it's going to bring you to our live program itself. And just stay there if you're able to do that. So if you're not able to do that, you can also text to the phone number 22333, as you can see here. That's going to be the number that you text to. And all you have to do is text MS21. Again, if you have any questions, we have some folks walking around to help you out. That's going to bring you to a text message that's going to come up there. It's going to have my name. It's going to say you've joined my poll everywhere. Just click on that link, and then it's going to bring everybody to where we need to move forward next. Just three things you need to put in there. Once you get there, click on the green Get Started button. Then that's going to bring you to a thing, a page that says, I am a presenter or I am a participant. You are a participant, so that will let you in there. And then it's going to say Join Presentation. So all you have to do in there is type MS21. I know it's a lot of instructions, but we're here to help you out. So if you're not in there just yet, we will help to get you in there.
You missed putting in my bank account to be able to.
Yeah. Yes, and accept all the cookies, because that lets us get into all of that personal information. Just kidding. So then you're there online, and you should be good. So I'm hopeful that we can get some folks in there, and it'll be a fun set of activities. So here is the first one. So if you're able to get in there, we want to know what you want to be for Halloween. I see some great things here. A Weimaraner, I love that. Halloween coming up, this is going to be fun. I said I want to be sleeping. And these are just some tests activities. Superman, I love it. Happy. Oh, I love that. That's great.
I scare everybody just the way I am. I don't know how.
Oh, I love this. I love that happy is coming up as, you know, the most, the biggest thing. Sane, that is fantastic. Super grandma, I love it. Oh, this is amazing. This is great. It looks like we've got a lot of people who are online. That's great. All right, we'll have to share all of our responses maybe after the program with everybody. But this is great. But I do love to see that a lot of people want to be happy, which I think is very positive and great. Okay, so this is going to be a little bit of a test. So we have three logos here. Click on the logo. You should be able to click, or just if you're not connected, just, you know, try and guess. But click on the logo of the company or organization that was founded in 1986. And we can see here we've got lots of people. So the Disney logo, CMSC, and Apple. Oh, it's neck and neck, CMSC and Apple. Wow.
Do you give the answer?
Yep, I'll give the answer. Yeah. Yep, so in fact, it was, I think we've got some very, very informed people here. Yes, it is in fact CMSC. And an amazing organization helping to support those living with MS, and I think that, you know, they're just fantastic. They have over 200, if you don't know, CMSC actually has over 250 member centers in the United States and Canada, and they actually represent 12,000 healthcare professionals who are here to support those living with MS. So they're a great organization. All right. This company employs approximately 77,000 employees in one location. So in one place, they employ 77,000 employees. So is it Amazon? Is it Twitter? Or is it Disney? Got some pretty informed people here. I think you guys are just great. I think you're seeing our theme here. So it is Disney. I should clarify, it is Walt Disney World. So here in Orlando, 77,000 employees. I was blown away by that when we learned that. But Amazon actually has 950,000 employees total. And Twitter, which was surprising to me, 5,500 employees. That's it. So I was really surprised by that. All right, this is our last one. Who uses the mantra, I have MS, I have a team, I have a future? We have the IOMSN, MS Teamworks, and I'm sorry, we have the third one. I'm sorry.
American Medical Association.
We have the third medical association.
It's not the third one, obviously.
I thought I was prepared. Oh, I'm so glad to see this. Yes, MS Teamworks. If you haven't had a chance to check out MS Teamworks, it's we have 81 videos on there, and it is a whole collection of information for MS patients and care partners, and we have clinicians and people telling their stories. So it's just msteamworks.com. I really encourage you to take a look at that. So great job. This was a great job, everyone. All right, so before we move on to bringing on our distinguished faculty, I am going to invite Stuart Schlossman to come up here. He's the founder of MS Views and News. And while Stuart joins us, we're going to take just a moment to recognize our first supporter. So thank you, everybody, and it'll be a great day with us.
Consortium of Multiple Sclerosis Centers and Catamount Medical Education would like to thank Biogen for their generous support of this program. This support has made it possible for us to provide this valuable education program for people living with MS and their care partners.
Howdy. Good afternoon. So nice to see you all again in Orlando, isn't it? It's awesome, right? Let them all know how much you appreciate being here. Give them a round of applause what they're doing here. That's great. That's great. So for those that don't know, I mean, most of you in the room do know, my name is Stuart Schlossman, and I am president and founder of MS Views and News. Okay, but I'm not here for MS Views and News today. I'm here for the Consortium of Multiple Sclerosis Centers, who do everything that they could possibly do throughout the United States with the nurses and others to educate them, and so that way they could bring you the best that they can, all right? But that's not why I'm up here either. I'm actually here to introduce a person. But before I introduce that person, you know, a lot of you know me as running around. Nobody's clicking on the screen, so I don't know when to click. Click, 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 click. You clicking?
You have a clicker there.
No. They were going to click for me. Oh, there we go. Okay. So that's about MS Views and News, all right? But you all know about that already. This is what we do. This is what we've excelled in doing that much further during COVID, okay? And we're just providing a tremendous amount of virtual programs each month right now, and I'm sure you all are part of it. All right. That's, again, another subject. You can contact me later about that. Today, and before I introduce this person, this wonderful doctor that's about to speak to you, when it was worked out that I was going to be introducing Dr. Shapiro, I remembered when I was diagnosed with MS in 1998, and I didn't have a lot of places to turn, like you all know, when you're looking for information about MS. But somehow I found a book that was given to me, this book, all right? And it was written by Dr. Shapiro, amazingly, right? So this guy helped me learn so much about multiple sclerosis at an earlier age. This was 1998. All right, it was the beginning of the internet, basically. But I had all this to read about Dr. Shapiro. The other morning, before I left to come here, I opened up this book and I found all these earmarked pages that I had turned in back in 1998 to see what I was learning at that time. And I found that, wow, all these symptoms that are in this book, I still have. What happened? They didn't get rid of my MS yet, but you know what? I got stronger for everything that I learned from Dr. Shapiro, from what I learned from the other educators that are involved with the Consortium of Multiple Sclerosis Centers, and for what we are doing and providing to all of you with multiple sclerosis. All right? I'm not taking up any more of your time because my time is probably up. Click. Whoever's got it. Oh, I got the click. See, I forget this all the time. So next we have Dr. Shapiro. So Dr. Shapiro is going to be speaking with you, all right, about a journey through the history of multiple sclerosis and what it means for all of us today. So let's welcome up Dr. Shapiro, and I'm going to say adieu.
Thanks, Stu.
Thank you.
Appreciate it very much. Thank you. What we've determined is that I'm old. That's what we've determined from Stu's looking back like that. And because I'm old, I get a chance to talk about the history of multiple sclerosis with you because I lived it. It's never the thing that I like. I like this slide. What a know-it-all. He acts like he's an expert on history. I wouldn't argue with him. He was around when history was happening, and that's really the case for most of what I'm going to talk to you about today. But when I talk about the history of multiple sclerosis, I need to give credit to Dr. Jock Murray. Dr. Murray is a Canadian. He was the dean of the Dalhousie School of Medicine and the head of neurology department up in Halifax, Nova Scotia. And he wrote the book on the history of multiple sclerosis. It's a book that's about that thick, and it actually reads pretty well. I don't suggest that you read it. You might want to purchase it, but you want to read it and keep it as a reference. So whenever I talk about this, I need to give homage to Dr. Murray, who's still around and kicking, but up in Halifax, Nova Scotia. You know, MS is a heterogeneous disorder with variable clinical and pathological features reflecting different pathways to tissue injury. Inflammation, demyelination, and axonal degeneration are the major pathological mechanisms that cause the clinical manifestations. Stuart's loving that I'm reading this. However, the cause of MS remains unknown. The most widely accepted theory is that MS begins as an inflammatory, immune-mediated disorder characterized by autoreactive lymphocytes. Later, the disease is dominated by microglial activation and chronic neurodegeneration. That's what MS is. It sounds really complicated, doesn't it? I mean, it makes it sound like this is really a complicated physiological disease that we can't understand. And I put that way because it sounds like it's a modern disease. And Stuart told me that he hates doctors that get up and just read slides, so I had to do that just for him. But MS is not a new disorder. It's not a new modern disease. It's been around for a long time. Matter of fact, we can look back in the Bible, and maybe these people had multiple sclerosis. These people who were blind and were given sight. These people who were lame and were able to walk. These people who were cured of many of their maladies may have had remissions and exacerbations of scattered neurologic abnormalities. I hate being the historian because I lived through history. You know, St. Lewina was born in Holland, and I knew her back in 380 AD, and when I used to visit her, I used to walk through the streets of Holland there. They looked something like this, and I saw St. Lewina. St. Lewina was an interesting gal. She got multiple sclerosis at a relatively young age, but she thought that she had the disease because she assumed all the sins of all of her friends and people around her. And felt very bad about all of that. Then she fell while skating and broke a rib, and shortly thereafter, I diagnosed her with multiple sclerosis back then. But at the time of the Revolutionary War, there was Augustus d'Este. He was the grandson of King George III, cousin of Queen Victoria. He was a very sensitive young man who was actually the product of an illegitimate marriage. And because he was a product of that illegitimate marriage and the marriage was annulled, he was expelled from the royalty and lived a not-so-nice life for the rest of his 34 years later after that. But he was one of the first recorded cases of multiple sclerosis, Augustus d'Este. Robert Carswell was an artist, and a medical artist, and in 1838, he drew the classic picture of multiple sclerosis. That picture looks like that. It's very much a classic picture of multiple sclerosis back in that era, 1838. Can you imagine back then? We knew all about what multiple sclerosis looked like at that level. But the father of neurology, my father, Jean-Martin Charcot, you can tell that he was my father because look at our noses. They're the same nose, you see? And so he was my father, and he described multiple sclerosis in a series of three lectures and became known as the namer of multiple sclerosis in French. And so he named multiple sclerosis, and we began to understand the disease a lot more following him. In 1891, I did my first spinal tap. I'm sure, how many of you have had spinal taps? Yeah. You know, I got really good at it. I got so I could take the needle and throw it across the room and it went right in, no problem whatsoever. That was in 1891. I've had a lot of practice since then. The cell that makes myelin was described, the oligodendrocyte, in 1899. And we're still working on how do we get those oligodendrocytes to make more myelin when we lose myelin along the way. James Dawson published his first major work on the plaque of MS in 1915. We do research on animals, but no animal actually has multiple sclerosis. But we've been able to create in a mouse a disease that looks like multiple sclerosis. and in a guinea pig and other mammals as well. That disease is called experimental autoimmune encephalomyelitis, and that was developed in 1933. Some of you have been on the Swank diet over the years. That was developed in 1950. In 1951, cortisone was used to treat multiple sclerosis. Now, I'm looking out over the audience, and most of you weren't born yet, but I was kicking around along that time, long before then. Cortisone was first used then. John Kurtzky, and we're going to come back to John, defined a disability status scale that we use to measure disability in people in 1955. John was a friend of mine. He passed away several years ago, not fairly recently, but several years ago. You're going to find that I had a lot of friends in the history of multiple sclerosis. It's not good to be a friend of mine because they tend to pass away along the way, and we'll see them as we go. In 1957, interferons were developed and discovered, not for multiple sclerosis. They interfered with viral replication, but we began to understand the immune system more at that time. In 1965, the initial criteria for diagnosing multiple sclerosis were described. I'm going to come back to that, but I want you to recognize that in 1965, I was just about to graduate from college, so we can see where we are in my time life in terms of multiple sclerosis management. In 1972, Ian McDonald and his colleague Halliday showed that nerve conduction within the brain and spinal cord were slowed in multiple sclerosis. I remember that because I was a resident in neurology training at that time, and that paper was presented to us, and I was amazed that this was another tool to look inside the nervous system to see what was going on. Now, remember back in 1972, we didn't have MRIs, we didn't have CAT scans, we had no way to look into the brain and see anything, so this was an electrical test that allowed us to see the conduction within the nervous system and if it was short-circuiting. And that allowed us some criteria to diagnose multiple sclerosis. That was pretty important back in 1972. Ian McDonald was a friend of mine. He passed away several years ago. In 1977, Larry Jacobs from Buffalo, gave interferon to MS patients in the spinal canal, injected it into the spinal canal. I remember that pretty astutely, too, because in 1977, I was a faculty at the University of Minnesota. I had created our MS center there, but nobody knew me. I was just a young kid, and I was at a meeting similar to this kind of meeting. It was a dinner meeting. I remember it very well, and this data was presented, and I raised my hand, and I objected to the way the study was done because I believed it wasn't people could tell when they got interferon. They got it squirted into their back, and they had a terrible reaction with fever and all this thing. So it wasn't blinded very well, and it would skew the results. And so I started raising questions, and the people who were, Dr. Jacobs didn't know me then. We became friends later. They got mad at me for asking the question, so I remember it really well. But that was in 1977. And then McDonald and Halliday began to look at how we diagnose multiple sclerosis a little bit more back then. And then baclofen was approved to treat spasticity, and I did the long-term safety studies on that over the years. It was in 1981 that I first saw my first MRI scan of the brain, and we began to be able to look inside the brain and see the abnormalities that are so characteristic of multiple sclerosis. Exciting times back at that point. In that era, the first images of MS were produced. And then in 1983, Charlie Poser looked at our diagnostic criteria, and we're going to come back to that in a moment, and said we can add some things that make it easier to diagnose multiple sclerosis. Charlie Poser was a friend of mine, and he passed away some years ago. Then in rapid succession, in 1990, the Americans with Disability Act was signed into law, and then we began to see medications. Betaseron, Copaxone, Avonex, Rebif, Mitoxantrone. We saw all kinds of medications, natalizumab. And then we got a whole plethora of medications. So we have so many medications we can't even list them on a slide really well anymore. That brings us to the present. But wait. You know, conventional medicine says take aspirin. In the absence of tort reform, defensive medicine says MRI and CAT scan. So everybody gets an MRI and sometimes a CAT scan. So I want to talk a little bit about Sylvia Lowry. Sylvia Lowry was a friend of mine. She passed away several years ago, but she founded the National Multiple Sclerosis Society. In 1946, she put an ad in the New York Times, and most of you know this story, in 1945, because her brother had multiple sclerosis and she was looking for some information on anybody that knew anything about multiple sclerosis to contact her. Not many people responded to that. And Sylvia started the National Multiple Sclerosis Society with one thing in mind, to find a cause and cure for multiple sclerosis. She was a dynamo. To be honest with you, she didn't really care so much about helping management of multiple sclerosis. She wanted to find a cause and cure for multiple sclerosis. She felt that if you got that, you could get rid of multiple sclerosis and not have to deal with it. Sylvia actually came to my center when we first started the center in the late 1970s. She didn't want to come to visit the center. She was forced to visit it by the people in Minnesota who wanted her to see this comprehensive MS center, the first of its kind in the country. She didn't want to do it, but she was forced to. And she came and had lunch with my team, physical therapy, occupational therapy, social workers, dietitians, the whole team. In 10 minutes, she alienated everybody, everybody, because the occupational therapist said, "What do you think of this team?" And she said something to the effect that, "We need to find a cause and cure for MS, and then we won't need you." And, you know, that was right. And I remember Sylvia, then we had a nice lunch, and I said to Sylvia, "I want to take you upstairs and show you the ward that we have." Back then, in the 70s, people were in the hospital with multiple sclerosis a lot, and we had a whole unit just for multiple sclerosis. I wanted to show her that. She didn't want to go upstairs. But there was a patient upstairs who really wanted to meet Sylvia. So I dragged her upstairs, and then she realized that what I was saying, when I called it ward, she was picturing this room with 15 beds in it, when these were private rooms that people had. And then she melted, and this patient got out of bed. She didn't walk very well, but that day she walked like she never walked before. She was so enthralled with Sylvia, she got out of bed and magically kind of crossed the room and shook hands with her goddess. And Sylvia was not the same person ever again, I don't think. And we became close friends after that. A really important person died in 2001. I want to talk a bit about the history of the consortium of multiple sclerosis centers that you're here and we're putting on this program for. This was founded in 1986 with a grant from the Mellon Foundation, working through the Cleveland Clinic. The doctor who founded it was a fellow by the name of Jack Conamy. Jack Conamy. He was the head of neurology at the Cleveland Clinic at the time, and he became a friend of mine, a good friend of mine. He passed away several years ago. But Jack founded the center with six founding centers, my center and five others. And now, as you heard, there are 250 member centers, over 12,000 healthcare professionals. Jack founded the Consortium of Multiple Sclerosis Centers, but the reason it got to be the way it is this young lady here that you're seeing, June Halper. She became the president, she became the CEO of the consortium along the way and really brought it into the modern era and made it a force in MS care. And so this is an organization that helps the professionals help you in dealing with multiple sclerosis. And she got the idea that we should put on a patient program associated with our annual meeting, and here we are doing that. She has more ideas and gets them done than anybody I've ever seen. So we owe a lot of homage and gratitude to June Halper for everything we do here at the consortium. But for a moment now, I want you to hop into the time capsule, and I want you to go back to when I was just entering medicine in 1965. In 1965, the workup for multiple sclerosis included all but, what do you think? All but, and I'll tell you the answer, is evoked potentials. We did a neurologic examination, we did spinal fluid, we looked for toxins in the blood, but we didn't have that ability to do that electrical test in 1965. What did we know in the 1960s? Well, surprisingly, we could diagnose multiple sclerosis in the 1960s. The diagnosis was clinical, and I preach and have preached over all these years that diagnosing multiple sclerosis is really easy. It's really easy, and I keep hearing how hard it is. It's the most difficult to diagnose disease. It's really easy. You just had to know the rules, and the rules were not hard. You needed somebody who was between the ages of 15 and 55. That's not hard. You needed somebody who had fluctuations of their neurologic symptoms. They should have come and gone to some degree. We call them remissions and exacerbations. That's not hard. You needed somebody who, when we examined them, had more than one abnormality in their nervous system, in their central nervous system, scattered neurological abnormalities. I was trained by the father of American neurology. His name was A.B. Baker. Dr. Baker founded the American Academy of Neurology. Dr. Baker passed away along the way. But Dr. Baker was brilliant and a teacher, and he said, if you have those three things, you have MS 99 times out of 100. Maybe he wasn't entirely accurate, but not bad, not bad. But it did mean you couldn't make the diagnosis with the first attack. You needed to have more than one attack. It did mean you couldn't make the diagnosis with a normal neurologic examination. You needed to have more than one abnormality on your neurologic examination. So that meant that the first attack, you went to the neurologist and they hesitated and they did this and a dance and that. But after the second attack, you should have been able to make the diagnosis if the neurologic examination was abnormal. So that was the Baker criteria. But in 1965, George Schumacher from the University of Vermont codified that criteria and wrote it up and made it easy to understand, and then added another thing to it and said, well, we should eliminate any potential other disease that might look like MS, so we had to do some tests. We looked at the spinal fluid. It wasn't of much value. We had this thing called colloidal gold testing. I remember doing that. It wasn't of much value, but we did look at it. In the 1960s, we treated MS sometimes by giving people typhoid fever. You gave them a shot of typhoid fever, and they got this terrible fever. We called it fever therapy. You can imagine what happened when they got that fever. I mean, they look like a piece of wet something. Just terrible. And then when the fever went away, supposedly people got better. Now, I remember that because my mother had multiple sclerosis, and she was treated that way. And I thought she was going to die when I was a kid that way, but she didn't die, and she didn't get better. I mean, it really didn't work, and it still doesn't work today, even though I've heard somebody on television talking about fever for COVID or something. I get nonsense stuff that you hear from that. But we gave IV vitamins, too. Every vitamin you can imagine, intravenously, in the arm, in the hospital. So when somebody says to me, well, my vitamins take care of my multiple sclerosis, I can smile and say, yes, I'm glad they do, but I know they don't. Because we gave every vitamin you can imagine, and if it worked, we'd still be doing that. And then we began to use adrenal corticotropic hormone, a cortisone-type medicine, and that seemed to make people better, at least over the short haul. So I want you to meet Linda. Linda is a 1960s Minnesota woman. And Linda, when she was 30 years old, developed a sudden onset of decreased vision and slight weakness in her left leg. She had a history 2 years earlier of weakness in the right leg for 2 weeks. That spontaneously cleared. Linda has multiple sclerosis. And the workup back in the 1960s included a history and examination. We take a history and examination. We did a brainwave test because we did brainwave tests when people had neurologic disease. It never showed anything in this case, but we did that. We would do a spinal tap, and then we would dump her into a hot tub of water. Because heat makes the symptoms of MS worse. Typhoid fever did that. And then we'd examine Linda again, and see how things had changed. And we could tell this was multiple sclerosis. And then we treat her with IV vitamins because we didn't have much else to do. And we give sometimes some ACTH in a shot or in an intravenous. And that was the 1960s. I want you to meet Susan. In the 1970s, she comes from New York. Susan looks more sophisticated than my Minnesota colleague. But in the 1970s, the workup for multiple sclerosis included all but, and the answer here is MRI. We got that evoked potential in the 1970s. We could look at the spinal fluid. We did an examination, but we didn't have scans back in the 1970s. So what did we know in the 1970s? Well, the diagnosis was still clinical. George Schumacher codified that. We had the spinal fluid. We got the evoked potentials. The spinal fluid got better. We began to look at immune abnormalities in the spinal fluid. Still pretty gross, but better. Still. And we treated Susan with IV ACTH. And then we began to understand that maybe the therapist, the physical therapist, the occupational therapist, it's just toward the end of the 70s, might be of some value to us. And that's our center started in that particular setting, the beginning of organized neural rehabilitation. So let's look at Susan. She developed the same symptoms that we talked about. Our workup for Susan now included a nuclear brain scan besides a history and physical. That didn't show us anything. We could do a CAT scan toward the end of the 70s. That didn't show us anything, but we did it. We did it looking to see if we could see anything. We look at the spinal fluid, we do evoked potentials, and then we would treat with IV, intravenous ACTH, and vitamins. So Joan came along in the 1980s. She looks like a California woman, doesn't she? And Joan, in the 1980s, what scientifically approved treatment for MS, what were the treatments for MS in the 1980s? Which one was scientifically proven? Well, the answer was sort of B. There was a study that showed that steroids did some improve people, but it wasn't the best study that we had. What did we know in the 1980s? Well, Charlie Poser, this fellow that I mentioned earlier, looked at the tests that we had in the 1980s and the imaging that we got in the 1980s and the electrical tests that we had in the 1980s and said, maybe we can use those to help with the clinical criteria that I told you about to help make the diagnosis earlier and with more authority. So we got the Poser criteria. We had the Schumacher criteria, age, relapsing and remitting, multiple abnormalities. Now we had the Poser criteria. We could add these lab tests and we could talk about laboratory-supported, clinically definite multiple sclerosis. We had evoked potentials, and then came the piece de resistance, the MRI. And we treated people with high doses of steroids. So that's when we started using 1,000 milligrams of methylprednisolone, salumedrol, and high doses of dexamethasone. And we began to do more neurorehabilitation. We were doing things then. In the hospital mostly, but doing things, symptomatic treatments. I had a whole unit devoted to multiple sclerosis, 21-bed rehab unit. We had 18 beds filled all the time doing these things for people who are having acute attacks and problems with their multiple sclerosis. So let's look at June then, in the 1980s, 30 years old, same symptoms that we saw before. Her workup back then, had the history and physical and the spinal fluid, but most importantly back then, she had an MRI. And we could look into her brain and we could see the abnormalities associated with multiple sclerosis around the ventricles and in the brain. What a difference that made. That meant that a lot of insecure neurologists, not our faculty here, but a lot of insecure neurologists could say, yeah, this is multiple sclerosis. But the faculty here said, yeah, we don't need that. It's multiple sclerosis. We knew, you know. Management back then included intravenous methylprednisolone, and people got stretching exercises. Not a lot of rehab, but some. In the 1990s, we met Sylvia, a Washington woman, Washington State woman. Sylvia, in the 1990s, what scientifically approved treatment in MS was available to us? Well, I'll tell you that in the 1990s, if you were around, you remember bee stings. You remember cobra venom, because they were made big deals of on 60 Minutes and this and that. We had the answers, baloney answers. We knew that. No, all the neurologists. Calcium orotate was the German treatment. People flew to Germany to get that. When it didn't work, the doctor there said, well, you have American MS. It only works on German MS. True story, true story. But we got the ABCs of multiple sclerosis. We'll come to that. What did we know in the 1990s? Well, we still had our clinical diagnosis. The spinal fluid became far more elegant. And the MRI, my goodness, the MRI got really elegant. And we could see these spots. And we could then give contrast. And we could see the acute lesions because they lit up because the contrast went into the acute new lesions. And we began to see when those went away and when everything got degenerated and we lost brain tissue, we could see holes in the brain. We call those black holes. And those are evidence of degeneration in the brain that we don't like to see, black holes. But we could see these as this MRI became so much more elegant and continues to do that. In the 1990s, we suddenly were plunged into the era of studies, randomized, double-blind, placebo-controlled trials. It was really important that we do placebo-controlled trials because the placebo effect in multiple sclerosis is 65%. By that I mean 65% of the time, no matter what I give you, you'll get better for a while, just for a while. Now, I don't know that I understand it entirely because I mean really get better. I don't mean just think you're better. I mean your exam looks better, you feel better, everything gets better for a while. Is it mind over matter? Is it endorphins? Is it, I don't know what it is, but we have to fight that placebo effect. We have to do better than placebo, so you have to do double-blind studies where you don't know what you're getting and the investigator doesn't know what you're getting and it's all coded and you have to do better than placebo. And we had to learn about how to do studies in multiple sclerosis. Up until then, we studied MS. We took people who were bedridden and people who were ambulatory, put them in the same pot, gave them the same medicines, the same dose, and nothing worked. And so we thought we have to divide people up into categories. And we knew that 80 to 85% of people with MS began their journey with a fluctuating course. So we called that relapsing remitting multiple sclerosis. And we knew that along the way, over half of them would slowly stop having those relapses, remissions, and slowly get worse. So we called that secondary progressive multiple sclerosis. And we knew that 10% got worse from the get-go, so we called that primary progressive multiple sclerosis. And 5% didn't read the book and started out progressive and then began to relapse, so we called that progressive relapsing multiple sclerosis. We did that to do studies. That's the reason people were divided. It was multiple sclerosis. We weren't playing games with it. We just were dividing it into categories so you didn't put bedridden people next to ambulatory people in the same study. And so we said, let's study just the early people, the relapsing remitting people, and let's do that. And we did that with Betaseron, the first real drug that was approved for multiple sclerosis. And lo and behold, it worked. It decreased the relapse rate and slowed the disease down. So we had a drug. The FDA said, well, wow, you got a drug. This drug is approved for. And we thought they were going to say multiple sclerosis because that's what it was. But they didn't. They said this drug is approved for relapsing, remitting multiple sclerosis, like it was a disease. And then we got Avonex, and we got Copaxone, and we got Rebif, and they were all approved for relapsing forms of multiple sclerosis. And suddenly it was like we had different diseases. Relapsing, remitting, secondary progressive, primary progressive, progressive relapsing. We didn't, it wasn't really meant for that. And it got to be misused. But you know what? I didn't care. I can tell you Dr. Birnbaum in that era, he didn't care. Because we could treat whoever we wanted to with whatever we wanted to. That we had a drug and we could do that. Until the insurance company said, Dr. Shapiro, you're the doctor. You can give this person what you call secondary progressive Betaseron if you want. That's up to you. We just won't pay for it. And suddenly all of our patients had relapsing remitting MS or whatever. I mean, it changed the flavor of everything. Now we're learning much more about what makes somebody relapse, what makes them progressive without relapses, and we're changing the classification around some more as we do that. But we began to do statistics to see how things would really work. It was the era of clinical studies. And we had head-to-head trials of different drugs against each other.
and we treated very differently. We started using very high-dose corticosteroids with people who had acute attacks. Neurorehabilitation became much more elegant and much more used and much more advocated for. And we got much more aggressive with symptom management. Stuart showed the book that has had six editions now. He had the third edition. It's had six editions because symptom management is so important. And then we learned that if you really go after that immune system and suppress it, it will slow MS down in a cadre of patients. Not everybody, but in a cadre of patients. And so we had very high intensity immunosuppressive agents like cyclophosphamide and IV cladribine. These were agents used in cancer therapy. We would exchange the plasma. We did a study where we took out the plasma and threw that away. I'm sorry, gave it back and took out the white cells. We called that lymphocytopheresis. We removed everybody's, as much as we could, white cells. They kept coming back, but that slowed MS down. And then we got beta interferon and glatiramer acetate, and which is easier to use than any of those others and worked more effectively. So we began to have treatments for multiple sclerosis. So let's look at Sylvia then, in the 1990s. Same disease as everybody else had. We would do a history and physical. We would do an MRI, maybe not so much spinal fluid because we got the diagnosis already without that. And then we would treat with high-dose steroids and then put them on a glatiramer acetate or a beta interferon. We did a lot of educational programs, a lot of symptom management, including neurorehabilitation. And now we have Lydia in the 2000s. She came from Florida. She looks like she came from Florida, doesn't she? In the 2000s, the approved treatment for multiple sclerosis included what of these? Well, actually, the answer is B. Times changed. What did we know in the 2000s? Well, the diagnosis was still clinical, but that Ian McDonald that I told you about, that friend of mine who liked MRI, he would look at those MRIs and he'd say, this MRI looks like MS, this one doesn't. This one this is MS because it has so many lesions in such a position in such a place that you can say from the MRI that this one is highly likely to be multiple sclerosis. And we got much more sophisticated with the McDonald criteria. Spinal fluid became much more elegant. The MRI was amazing. It just didn't correlate with how people looked, but it allowed us to make the diagnosis very much easier. So we were in the era of evidence-based medicine. We had beta interferons, several. We had glatiramer acetate. We had intense immunosuppression with cancer drugs. And then we got more specific. We started looking at specific areas of the immune system. Can we develop a drug to knock out, instead of throwing a bomb into the immune system with a cancer drug, can we knock out a little piece of the immune system? And we got a drug called Antigrin, anti-integrin antibody, better known as natalizumab or Tysabri. And that drug was very specific. So let's look at our Lydia in the 2000s here. She got her workup with a history and physical, but that MRI told us a lot. We could even look at her eyes a little bit better with an OCT test. And then we would treat with high-dose steroids, put her on a medication that we had available, glatiramer acetate, beta interferon, natalizumab, treat with education, symptom management. Sometimes we would do plasma exchange or intravenous immunoglobulin, and sometimes we were more aggressive with more specific medication, very different from the past. And then in the present is Sasha. She comes to us from Michigan. And in the decade that we're in now, what do we know? What do we know? Well, the diagnosis is clinical. McDonald has gone through several iterations in terms of the MRI activity. The spinal fluid is elegant, much more elegant. The MRI continues to amaze, and we're now focused on a lot of minutiae with it. Our medications abound, lots of medications. The knowledge of the immune system is grown every day. Gosh, I went to a talk this morning and it's like it's a different world. That says we've learned so much about the disease. And you know, MS has changed. The disease has changed. Changed significantly. I want you to think back into 1994 before we had any medications. Let's say you were all out here back then in 1994 and I were to say to you, I have got a drug that I want to do a study on. But for you to be in the study, you have to have MS. And you can't have been on any MS medication. Well, there were none, so that was easy. How many of you want to be in the study? I'd see all these hands go up. If I ask this question today, and I will do it right now, I have a new drug. I don't really, but if I did, I have a new drug. And to be in the study, you have to have MS, and you can't ever have been on any MS medication. How many of you are eligible for the study? Yeah. None. All of you would have your hands up before. Now, the only people who are eligible are who? Newly diagnosed, they haven't had a chance to be on medicine, or people who are averse to medicines. They don't want to be on any medicine. So our population of patients for studies is much smaller in order to tell whether these drugs really make a difference. And the statistic, we need more patients, because if you get early people, it's not the same as people who have had the disease for a while and the disease has set in and having more problems. So we have to understand that. And we have drugs, and so people are treated. So now we have to do comparative trials. And it's changed. The patients that are available today are very different from before. And our criteria to entrance into a study has changed. Now we have MRIs, and so people are getting into the studies earlier. It's a different disease earlier. And now when I asked, we want to do a study on a drug, centers don't have eligible patients in the numbers that they used to have because they're all being treated. So we have to take more than one center. We have to go to multiple centers in multiple countries who treat multiple sclerosis in multiple ways. It changes the way we do things because the disease has changed. It changed so much so that the placebo groups in the trials have fewer relapses because they're so early in the process of the disease. So the annual relapse rate in every trial has diminished from what the way it used to be, because the disease has changed. To show you how it's changed, you take a drug like Rebif, for example, and you look at the old trial, at what happened to the relapse rate then, and then Rebif is used in another trial as a comparator, and what was the relapse rate there? It's much different, it's much lower. The same drug, same dose, same disease. Because people are different. We've really accomplished a lot. And we have lots of medicines. I put up this slide, and the people, organizer said, nobody can read it. And I said, yeah, they're not supposed to read it. I don't want you to read it. I just want you to get the feel. This is what's happened, an explosion of medicines, 25 different medicines for multiple sclerosis. They're not all different. Some of them are me-toos and this and that and the other. But we went from none to all of these medicines. So Sasha, today, she comes in with the same history. She gets her workup, MRI, maybe spinal fluid, OCT. We certainly look at her with a history and physical. She gets high-dose steroids for her acute attack. She gets a lot of education. She gets symptom management, including neurorehabilitation. And then we have to figure out which drug for which person gets what, when. And that's where art and science come together, and that's where it is today. A very different picture from the way it was when I started. And it really means that I have to spend more time. I'm retired, so I don't have to spend any time at all, but I would have to spend more time with somebody to educate them, because we're in the era of shared decision-making. Shared decision-making. I don't like that era. You know, the reason I don't like that era is I've spent my life studying all of this. Somebody comes in, they've got multiple sclerosis. I appreciate that. But what do they know? They may know a lot, or they may know little. And they want to choose a drug because why? They saw it on television. It looked good on television. That's not the way we choose drugs, really. And so that means I recognize that this is the era of shared decision making, because if I just make the decision and you don't want to take it, what have we accomplished? So I have to educate you about why I want this particular drug and not that particular drug, knowing that maybe you didn't come in with that idea, and then be responsible for that. So it's exciting, though, because of all of the possibilities that we have today that we did not have when I started here. So I come back to Sylvia Lowry. Sylvia Lowry, the grand dame of multiple sclerosis. She wanted to know the cause and cure of multiple sclerosis, but you know what? We still don't know the cause and cure for multiple sclerosis. So with all the progress that we've made, Sylvia is still upset about what's going on. I can hear her from above. We have a long way to go. But you know, history teaches us many things. But foremost, two of the greatest qualities to have in life are patience and wisdom. If you get that. Thank you very much.
The Consortium of Multiple Sclerosis Centers and Catamount Medical Education would like to thank Bristol-Myers Squibb for their generous support of this program. This support has made it possible for us to provide this valuable education program for people living with MS and their care partners.
Good afternoon, everyone. Are you having a good time? Are you learning something? All right, well, I'm not a doctor or a presenter, but I think while I'm up here, you may learn a few interesting facts, actually fun facts. I'm here to do the fun job. So if you would go ahead and get your phone ready, we are going to be doing another Poll Everywhere activity. And this one's called Two Truths and a Lie. All right, and so what we want you to do is we want you to find the lie. So as you see on your screen, we are asking you to choose the statement that is false. A pumpkin is a fruit. Candy corn was originally called chicken feed. Jack-o'-lanterns originated in Germany. Does everybody have their smart devices? If you need help, just raise up your hand and we will wait. Does anybody need help? Told you would learn something today while I'm up here. Obviously, these wonderful presentations, we're all learning something. All right, well, I think everyone has pretty much maybe chosen an answer. And most of you chose candy corn was originally called chicken feed, but actually, the lie is jack-o'-lanterns originated in Germany. They actually originated in Ireland. And as the story goes, an Irish man named Stingy Jack tricked the devil and therefore was not allowed into heaven or hell. So he spent his days roaming the earth carrying a lantern, and he went by the name Jack of the Lantern. Try not to get goosebumps when you're carving your pumpkins this year. All right, are we ready for the next one? All right, two truths and a lie. Here we go. Choose the statement that is false. The overall risk of fetal complications during pregnancy is no different for those with MS than it is for those without MS. Women living with MS should not breastfeed. MS flare-ups tend to decrease during pregnancy. Go ahead and pick your answer. Many of you are changing your minds. All right, well, the lie up here is that women living with MS should not breastfeed. Studies show that breastfeeding is safe for people with MS and their babies and could even be beneficial. So, okay, on to the next one. Are you learning something? Some really good trivia, right? Okay, all right. So the next one is, again, you're gonna choose the statement that is false. People living with MS should avoid exercise because it may aggravate pain or make their fatigue worse. Exercise can give you better control over your bowel and bladder function. Or is the lie, it is important to stay cool? Getting too hot when you're exercising can temporarily increase your MS symptoms. And we have some experts in the room, because the lie is people living with MS should avoid exercise because it may aggravate pain or make their fatigue worse. Actually, studies have shown that exercise can help improve symptoms in people living with MS. All righty, we have our last one. You ready? Choose the statement. That is false. Walt Disney World's 50th anniversary is an 18-month celebration. Walt Disney World is approximately the same size as Boston, Massachusetts. The opening day crowd on October 1st, 1971 at Disney's Magic Kingdom Park was approximately 10,000 guests. Which one is the lie? I love watching the bars grow and decrease. All right, well, the lie is Walt Disney World is approximately the same size as Boston, Massachusetts. Can you believe that it's actually approximately the same size as San Francisco, California? Isn't that crazy? All right, well, I hope that you learned some fun facts and maybe some trivia that you can share. And at this time, I would like to welcome Dr. Gary Birnbaum to join us for his presentation on MS research. Would you welcome him today?
Okay, well, thank you very much for inviting me. I will be talking about MS research that's happened in the past year. So I receive about 100 articles a week from the National Library of Medicine on MS. Some of it's new, some of it's old. So this is obviously a very selected and skewed synopsis, if you will, of the amount of work that's going on. There's an enormous amount of work that's really happening. There's my website, you have it there in front of you, and I will be adding to it on a fairly regular basis. So I've divided my talk into three phases. The first is new insights into the pathology of MS, in other words, what is happening at the tissue level. I will talk a little bit about new concepts in the treatment of MS. And of course, what everyone is most excited about, perhaps in a bad way, is the association between MS, the virus SARS-CoV-2, and the disease COVID-19. Now, at the bottom of some of my slides, you'll see things in blue. Those are actually the websites of the articles that I'll be referring to. I'm sure you can't make much of them on the presentation here, but you have that information, and it'll be online for you to look at further if you so choose. So let's talk about aging. All of us in this room are getting older, and as we age, things happen to us, obviously. And one of the things that happens is that our chromosomes are altered. As we live, our cells multiply, and as our cells multiply, the chromosomes actually get shorter. And that piece of the chromosome that is shortened is called the telomere. So you can tell the age of a particular cell by how short the telomeres are of the chromosomes of that cell. Now, this does not determine your age or your lifespan. It's an indication of biologic age. So you can sort of identify people as they age on the basis of the shortening of their telomeres. Now, in addition to this alteration in your chromosomes, as we age, our immune system begins to get weaker, a phenomenon called immunosenescence. And as a result of this normal aging, this is not abnormal, as a result of this normal aging, cells have less ability to multiply, they have less ability to repair the damage to their DNA, they can't respond to all of the stresses that we experience in the course of our lives. And in addition, this is most unusual, no one really understands why, but in the aging immune system, it begins to secrete substances called cytokines that increase inflammation. And that's a phenomenon that's been called inflammaging. Now, how does this relate to MS? Well, there's been multiple studies now that have compared biologic aging in persons with MS to those that do not have this illness. And it seems to show fairly persuasively that biologic aging occurs earlier in persons with MS. This is on the basis of their telomeres being shorter and also alterations in the immune cell population that occur normally but seem to occur sooner in persons with this illness. And there's been a correlation, actually. If you look at people with MS who have the most significant alterations in their aging parameters, they more rapidly progress in terms of their disability, and they seem to have more of a tendency to develop progressive disease. So there is this very important observation that has implications in terms of disease-modifying therapies. And I'll talk more about that in just a few minutes. So the implications, of course, are that the ability to repair the central nervous system is going to be decreased earlier in people who have MS. There's going to be a worsening of degeneration because of this inflammation. You're releasing inflammatory cytokines. And as a result, you may have less ability to respond to disease-modifying therapies. There's very persuasive data that the older a person gets, the less their response to disease-modifying therapies. In addition to the response, there may also be a decreased response to the toxicities of disease-modifying therapies. So, can this be reversed? Is there anything that we can do to maybe modify it or ameliorate it? Well, there are many, many drugs that are now being called senolytics. You may have heard of them, and they're shown to you here. I don't expect you to be able to see all these things, but suffice it to say that there are many various compounds that are being investigated as we speak for their ability to affect immunosenescence and alter the course of a person's aging. Will we ever be young again? I don't know. I certainly can't promise you that. But what I can say is that these particular agents will not show up in any clinical practice until they've been shown to make a difference. So this is a long ways off, but at least you should be aware that a lot of research work is happening in this particular area. So let's talk about diet. Dr. Shapiro talked about diet to a certain extent. There isn't really any proven MS diet that makes a difference, but there is certainly an effect on the immune system in terms of what a person eats. And that's the result of this very important fact that there are trillions of bacteria that we have in our gut. We actually have more bacteria in our gut than we have cells in our body, which is humbling. And these bacteria, which are called the gut microbiome, reside adjacent to millions of immune cells. So your intestine, your gut, is actually a very important immune organ. And these bacteria communicate with the immune cells and affect them. Bacteria secrete various compounds and substances, and some of these particular substances suppress the immune system, and some of these particular substances agitate the immune system and actually make it more inflamed. So what we eat has an integral effect on the immune system, and people have looked at populations of bacteria in the gut of persons with MS, and they're different. than they are in people who do not have this illness. This is seen in other autoimmune diseases also. There's no coherent picture, really. Each laboratory seems to find different things, but suffice it to say that bacteria in the gut of persons with MS are different. There's an interesting article that I have down here talking about the different agents that bacteria produce that do affect the immune system. But I think most interestingly is the fact that immune cells in the gut have the capacity to travel up into the central nervous system and affect inflammation there. This has been well established now and means that there is this complex interaction between your food, your gut bacteria, your immune system, and the ability of that particular gut immune system to modulate disease activity. Very exciting. So I said that there wasn't any particular diet for MS, but what about something all of us eat every day and that's essential for life? And that's salt. As you know, salt, wars have been fought over salt. It's really been extremely popular over the years. We have to have salt, of course. There was a series of observations made maybe 3 or 4 years ago in an animal model of MS called experimental autoimmune encephalomyelitis, where they fed high salt diet to mice, and these mice became sicker than mice that were not on a high salt diet. And they found that this was the result of the generation of certain toxic cells that were producing a substance called IL-17. Now, this work has become a little bit shakier now. It's been contradictory. This is mainly in experimental animals. So I was very excited to see this article on analyzing salt in people with MS. Now, you can't tell how much salt is in a person's body on the basis of just asking them how much salt do you add to your food or what do you add to your cooking. You can't tell how much salt is in a person's body by measuring the amount of salt in their urine. Salt is actually stored in our body in a complex fashion in different areas. And these particular investigators looked at salt in the skin of people with mild relapsing MS. And they found, much to their amazement, certainly my amazement, that the salt concentration was higher in men but not in women, as compared to age-matched controls who did not have this illness. Now, not all men had this happen. There was obviously always a diversity in these observations, but when they compared the MRIs of persons, of men, who had higher salt concentrations, they found that higher salt concentrations correlated with more active brain inflammation. Now, the numbers are small, and correlation does not mean cause and effect. We're a long ways from that, but it is interesting because it could explain why, as a group, males are more likely to have severe disease. And if this is indeed verified, if other investigators can find similar observations and can reproduce these data, this may allow therapeutic intervention by a modification of the intake of salt in people that have MS. So we're not there yet, but it's something that's very exciting. Okay, what causes MS? Well, we don't know, obviously, what causes MS. But there are two theories, and they're not necessarily mutually exclusive. I think, actually, my own personal opinion is that both are operative. So the first theory is obviously based on the observation that inflammation plays a critical role in the disease, and that the disease really starts because the immune system loses what's called immune tolerance. Tolerance is when the immune system ignores a particular organ and feels it's okay. That doesn't mean it's not looking at the organ, it just doesn't attack the organ. But in MS, the hypothesis is that the immune system is altered, and there are data in support of this, and that it loses tolerance, and because it now sees the brain as being different, it attacks it. So this is called the outside-in theory. The immune system outside of the central nervous system attacks the alternative theory, or perhaps not even an alternative one, a supplemental theory, if you will, is that the central nervous system in persons with MS is intrinsically not normal. Is it a persistent virus infection? Is it a genetic abnormality? There was this very exciting paper recently that showed that oligodendrocytes in persons with MS have a genetically defined inability to make certain proteins. So is it the central nervous system that perhaps loses cells? The interior of the cells leak into the blood. The immune system sees these novel proteins and reacts to it, and so then begins to attack the brain, not as a primary phenomenon, but secondary to something that's going on in the central nervous system. That's the inside-out theory. My own particular bias, if you will, that it's probably a combination of the two, that the central nervous system may not be entirely normal, but that the immune system is more susceptible to recognizing these particular brain antigens and respond to them in a bad way. All of us in this room have cells that have, even if you don't have MS, have cells that can respond to brain antigens, but they're regulated. So something in the MS immune system seems to be different in terms of allowing these cells to attack. So there was a recent paper that actually talked about this. It was a bunch of investigators that looked at all of the proteins in the spinal fluid. All of the proteins in the spinal fluid are called the proteome, and they just looked at individuals with and without MS in their spinal fluids. And they looked at four groups of individuals. They looked at individuals who had a clinically isolated syndrome, CIS. I'll be talking a lot about this in a few minutes. A CIS is the first episode of a disease that has a high risk of developing into definite MS. So it's very early. It's the early clinical manifestation of the disease. They looked at relapsing forms of MS, persons with other neurologic diseases, some of them inflammatory. So not all of them were non-inflammatory, and of course, individuals who did not have any neurologic disease. And they were able to divide the proteins in the spinal fluid, which was their main object of study, into two groups, those related to inflammation and those related to brain metabolism. In other words, the byproducts of what the cells in the central nervous system were producing as a result of their metabolic activity. So then, having these two groups of proteins, they then were able to characterize two groups of individuals, those that had inflammatory proteins in their spinal fluid and those that didn't. And what was interesting was that there were people with MS who did not have inflammatory proteins in their spinal fluid. Now you may say, wait, MS is an inflammatory disease. How could there be people with MS who did not have inflammatory proteins? Well, it turns out that if you looked at the group of individuals who did not have inflammatory proteins, it turned out to be individuals who had the CIS, the clinically isolated syndrome. So a high percentage of these individuals had abnormalities of metabolic proteins. There was evidence that their central nervous system cells were not functioning metabolically well, but did not have inflammation. So sort of supporting the concept that the central nervous system isn't as it should be, even in the absence of inflammation, and even with the appearance of a first neurologic episode. So all of the people with MS and CIS had decreased levels of brain metabolism, most noticeable very early in the disease. So what does this mean then? What are the implications of this? Well, the authors concluded that MS really is the result of a derangement in fundamental cell metabolism and energy metabolism, including a generation of myelin. And that if you really want to treat MS in its entirety, if you really want to have a cure for all aspects of the disease, you need a cocktail. You can't just have anti-inflammatory drugs. They're essential. We need them. That's what we have at the moment. We also need drugs that help in remyelination, in repair, essential. And we also need drugs that may provide energy for cells to multiply and to repair themselves, especially important in view of this immune senescence and the premature aging that I talked about earlier. Is there such a drug? Well, at the moment, it hasn't been proven, but I think last year I spoke about this nanoparticles of gold. It's basically a water suspension of tiny particles of gold that, for reasons we don't understand, improves cell metabolism. So this is a work in progress. As I said, studies are being done right now to see whether these nanoparticles of gold are of any benefit to people with MS. Again, a very exciting observation, certainly broadens the picture of our therapeutic armamentarium, or that might have to become our therapeutic armamentarium. So as Dr. Shapiro mentioned, there's been an explosion of disease-modifying therapies in the past several decades. I can also remember I didn't use fever therapy for my treatment. That was not something that I ever experienced. But there were certainly very, very limited options. And now we have so many disease-modifying therapies. And that's wonderful. That's good. But it's caused a lot of uncertainty and a lot of confusion, especially for healthcare providers that aren't specializing in MS. If you're a general neurologist and you're dealing with Parkinson's, Alzheimer's, stroke, seizures, and MS, and suddenly you have 24 disease-modifying therapies, what do you do? What's the best first-line drug? Should one start high or low? I'll talk more about this in a minute. And what's become increasingly important is what effect does treatment with a disease-modifying therapy have on subsequent disease-modifying therapies? All of our disease-modifying therapies affect the immune system. Some of these effects can last for weeks to months to years. So if you switch from disease-modifying therapy A and go to disease-modifying therapy B, is the effect of that subsequent disease-modifying therapy going to be the same, or have you altered the immune system in such a way that it's not going to be as effective? What are some of the drugs in the pipeline? And what about progressive MS? There's been really a very evolving concept on what constitutes progressive disease. So categories of disease-modifying therapy, there are two. They're so-called moderate efficacy drugs. They're shown to you here. They're sufficient to control disease in a large number of individuals. What's good about them is they've been around for a long time. The interferons and GA, glatiramer acetate, have been around for decades. They're safe. And they're, as I said, effective in a large number of individuals with minimal toxicity. Now, more recently, we have the high efficacy drugs. Most of those are injectable, except for clantrobine. Very effective drugs, able to suppress highly active inflammation, but they have the potential for more side effects and have the potential for more toxicity. So as I just mentioned to you, people with MS may be more susceptible to toxicities as they age because of immune senescence and premature biologic aging. So it's always a challenge. Now, I can't predict the course of MS, and that's been one of the main hurdles. So let me just backtrack a little bit about escalation therapy. Escalation therapy is based upon the approach that you don't know the course of MS. It can be very mild. I've seen people who've had MS for 20, 30 years that are running marathons. I have people with MS within 1 or 2 years that have a severe disability. So how can I predict? Well, I can't really predict. So if I can't predict, I will say to someone, you know, let's try something that's moderately effective, and if it doesn't work, I'll switch. That's called escalation therapy. On the other hand, there are people that say, well, you know, MS can be very, very severe, as we know that. I'm not going to wait. I'm just going to put this person on high-dose therapy. It's called induction therapy. Start with a more powerful drug, potentially more toxic, assuming that that individual is not going to do well. So the choice really depends upon the healthcare provider's ability to determine the risk for developing more severe disease, and that's a challenge. because you can't really with any certainty predict the course of a person's illness. But there are certain clues. If you're male, statistically, you're more likely to have more severe disease, multiple attacks with poor recovery, attacks affecting the motor and cerebellar systems. If your brain shows more inflammation, more tissue destruction, more actually atrophy or loss of tissue. If the spinal cord is involved, the brain is this big, the spinal cord is this big, its ability to withstand injury is much, much less. These are all potentially valuable ways of determining whether a person is going to have a more severely disabling disease, but they're relatively insufficient and inaccurate. So is there some other way? Well, this was a very exciting paper that I saw on predicting aggressive MS very early based upon an examination of the spinal fluid. Now, examination of the spinal fluid has been around for decades, as Dr. Shapiro mentioned. We look at antibodies in the spinal fluid. We look at IgG antibodies. We look for these oligoclonal bands. They have a certain prognostic value also. But there are many other classes of antibodies. There's IgM antibodies, which occur very early in the course of the immune response. There's IgA antibodies, IgE antibodies. So these particular investigators looked at IgM antibodies. And they looked at them in individuals with clinically isolated syndrome, very early in the course of their disease, who even haven't been diagnosed as having definite MS at this particular time. And they looked at antibodies, IgM antibodies, that bound to fats or lipids. Now, our brain is essentially all fat. Calling a person a fathead is actually biologically accurate. And they looked at these particular IgG and IgM antibodies in people very early in the course of their illness. And as expected, 80% of these people early in the course of their disease had IgG antibodies. But only 27% of those individuals had IgM antibodies. So not every individual early in the course of their disease had these particular fat-binding antibodies. So then they did something very exciting. They followed these individuals for up to 12 years and just asked the question, was there any difference in the clinical course between those that had IgM antibodies and those that did not? And the data are there for you to see. If you had IgM antibodies in your spinal fluid at onset of your MS, you had twice the risk of having a second attack, which made you having definite MS, twice the risk of developing progressive MS. So if I have the ability as a healthcare provider to look at IgM antibodies in the spinal fluid, and they're present, I can tell that individual, you know, maybe escalation therapy isn't for you. Maybe because of this additional predictor, if you will, for more severe disease, I think you should start off with a high efficacy medication, and I think the benefits and the risks are justified. So this hasn't happened yet. These are new data, and I think eventually it will become a part of our diagnostic armamentarium. Very exciting. So let's talk about changing disease-modifying therapies. As I mentioned to you, we don't have a cure for MS. You change disease-modifying therapy for two reasons. Either the disease isn't well controlled. Now, there's no cure, so there may always be a little bit of disease activity. You have to talk with your healthcare provider about what you think is, quote, acceptable disease activity, or that there's drug toxicity. So as I mentioned to you, will the effects of a previous therapy affect subsequent disease-modifying therapies? Either effectiveness or drug toxicity, the diagram on your left shows you all of the different disease-modifying treatments and their mechanisms of action, their MOAs. They're all different. So if you start with, as I said, agent A, switch to agent B, is the immune system altered in such a way that it affects subsequent responsiveness? And as I mentioned to you, all of these disease-modifying therapies can have prolonged effects. So there was a very recent paper that looked at this phenomenon. and it looked at MS patients who were on the high-efficacy medication alemtuzumab. So they looked at 170 individuals who were on alemtuzumab. Most were on this drug because they had failed a previous disease-modifying therapy. So this was their second agent. Some of these individuals were treatment naive. Now, obviously, their healthcare provider felt that their MS was sufficiently aggressive to put them on this high-efficacy medication. And they looked at two outcomes, subsequent disease activity on alemtuzumab and the side effects of alemtuzumab, which can be quite considerable. And the data are shown to you on your left. Most disease-modifying therapies did not affect the therapeutic profile or the side effect profile of alemtuzumab, but two did. In particular, fingolimod, which is an S1P inhibitor, a sphingosine-1-phosphate inhibitor, and to a lesser extent, natalizumab. So something was changed in those individuals' immune system such that alemtuzumab was unable to exert its beneficial effect. Indeed, if you compared fingolimod treatment with other disease-modifying therapies, fivefold increased risk of having a relapse if you'd been on fingolimod prior to alemtuzumab, sevenfold increase for developing sustained disability. And if you compare these individuals to those that had been on alemtuzumab as their first line agent, you found five times a higher risk of spinal cord involvement and of developing an other autoimmune disease, which is a well-known side effect of alemtuzumab. So what you experienced previously may have a significant effect on subsequent therapy. So what about potential treatments in the pipeline? What's happening with MS? Well, one interesting category of treatment, which is being studied to a large extent, which you'll hear a lot more about, is Bruton's tyrosine kinase inhibitors, which is fortunately abbreviated BTK. I'll talk about progressive forms of MS and therapies for that. And of course, exercise. You were all able to figure out that it's good to have exercise for MS, but I'll provide more data to persuade you, hopefully, even more strongly as to its benefits. So BTK, what is Bruton's tyrosine kinase? Well, it's a protein that affects, that is necessary for the function of multiple cells in your central nervous, in your immune system. As you know, there are two immune systems. There's the innate immune system, and there's the adaptive immune system. The innate immune system is the one that's at the front line. It's the one that is immediately affected if you cut yourself, if you have an infection, if you burn yourself. It's the immune system that's ready to go instantly. It doesn't have to mature. It doesn't have to adapt. And the cells of that particular innate immune system are different than cells in the adaptive immune system, monophages, monocytes, macrophages, dendritic cells, and most interestingly, there are cells in the brain called brain microglia that live there and that invade the brain during brain development. So they are initially present during pregnancy and they enter into your brain and they reside there. They live there. That's their home. They don't move. And these particular brain microglial cells have many, many functions. They obviously support brain tissue. They can help in the repair of brain tissue. They have the ability to phagocytose, clean up debris in the brain. But they've also been shown to be toxic. And so if you activate these brain microglia in the wrong way, they can actually be involved in chronic inflammation and in demyelination. In the adaptive immune system, BTK plays a very important role in the activation of B cells. We know that B cells are important. We have multiple medications that eliminate B cells, have a very strong therapeutic effect. BTK is another agent that's necessary for B cells to proliferate and to act. So if you can suppress BTK, you can have an effect not only on B cells, but also on these cells of the innate immune system, which really none of the other disease-modifying therapies are able to do. So now being studied are inhibitors of BTK. And what's good about them is they're small molecules. They can be taken orally. And most importantly, they can enter the brain. A lot of the other disease-modifying therapies are unable to do that. And the immune system in MS attacks the brain, but then it remains sequestered in the brain, compartmentalized, isolated in the brain. So if you have a disease-modifying therapy that can't address these intrinsic immune cells, you have a problem. And that might be one of the reasons why their effects for progressive MS is so limited. But these BTK inhibitors can enter the brain. They infect both adaptive cells and innate immune cells, in particular, these brain microglial cells. So there was just a published paper on a BTK inhibitor called tolebrutinib. It's one of at least three others that are being investigated. This particular class of medication has been used in other diseases. It's been used in cancers and been shown to be effective. There are potential side effects. It can cause abnormalities of blood clotting that has not been seen in people with MS. People with cancer have that as an intrinsic tendency. So this was a study that was a phase two trial. Now, a phase two trial is a proof of concept trial. Is this medication potentially an effective treatment for MS? So it's a smaller study, doesn't have as many centers involved in it, and they looked at the question, could administering this BTK inhibitor decrease inflammation in the central nervous system based upon MRI? And the data are shown to you on your left. You can see here they used five different doses of the drug, and with higher doses of this BTK inhibitor, there was a reduction in active inflammation in the brain and in the formation of new or enlarging lesions. So phase three trials are now being planned. Is this going to replace any of the other disease-modifying therapies? Is it going to be a supplement? What's interesting is that they're also studying it now in people who have progressive disease, no acute inflammation, on the assumption that because the BTK inhibitors can enter the brain, affect brain microglia, this may be a very important therapeutic advance. So we'll have to see. Very exciting. Now, progressive MS, you know, there's been a lot of discussion about this. What really is progressive MS? Is it a worsening of physical disability? Is it a worsening of fatigue? Is it a worsening of cognitive functioning, of thinking? What really is involved in progressive MS? There's very nice paper that I have that sort of summarizes it. But what's been known now for decades is if you look at the tissues of people very early in the course of MS, it has changes which are identical to those that you see in people who've had MS for 20 or 30 or 40 years. So the progressive aspects of the disease are present from onset. And there's no distinct transition from relapsing to progressive MS. As a matter of fact, there was this other paper that you have here in front of you by my colleagues in England who said MS is a primary progressive disease from onset, but some people have superimposed relapses. So actually, two separate things are going on. So progression is really something that occurs very early in the disease, and you can't suddenly say, well, you've stopped now having relapsing disease and you're now progressive. It's a gradual transition that becomes more apparent as relapses decrease over time. There's this new acronym now called PIRA, progression independent of relapse activity. Everyone's all excited about that now, but I've known this for decades. I can't tell you how often I've seen a patient in my practice and I say, how are you doing? And they say, I'm worse. I say, well, okay, let's have a look at you. I do an exam on this individual. I do an MRI scan. I look at their blood and everything's the same, but they're worse. So obviously my tools for identifying progression are inadequate. Progression is happening, needs to be addressed, And unfortunately, there really isn't any particular therapy. Now, there are two drugs that have been, quote, approved for progressive MS, as you know, ocrelizumab, an anti-B-cell antibody, and saponamide, a sphingosine-1 phosphate inhibitor. And they've been shown to delay progression of disability at 3 months in a statistically significant fashion. Now, what does that mean, statistically significant? It means that the probability of this difference happening by chance is unlikely. So it's a probability score. What's necessary in terms of really understanding what happens is it clinically meaningful? Does it really make a difference? It may be statistically significant. If I look at someone who has a dollar difference in their wallet, and I have enough of those individuals that have a dollar more than I do, it'll be statistically significant, but is it meaningful? So these observations are indeed real. Most of these medications, the ocrelizumab and saponamide, have had an effect on people with progressive disease who've had superimposed active inflammation. So they're sort of in that gray zone between pure relapsing and so-called pure progressive disease. So you have to ask yourself the question, if I'm going to start these medications, chances are you'll be older because you'll be diagnosed with progressive disease. You'll have less immune function. Disease-modifying therapy benefits decrease with age. Are the risks of going on a medication that, according to this one paper, really only affects about 2 weeks of disability per year, are the risks involved with taking these medications worth it? I can't answer that question. This has to be a discussion between you and your healthcare provider. I don't say you shouldn't be on this medication, but you have to realize the context in which it is being advised and used and whether it really is going to be of any benefit in terms of its risks. Okay, exercise. I can't tell you how often I've advised this to individuals with MS, and what if I, no time. Doc, I'm just too busy, too tired. I'm tired, I can't exercise. Or, you know, I don't know what to do. I have a disability. I can't do this, I can't do that, I can't jog. Exactly what do I do? So, as we heard from Dr. Shapiro, exercise is good. As you'll hear later on from my colleague, exercise is very important. It turns out that when you exercise, you actually change your body. You beneficially affect your gut bacteria, you reduce markers of brain inflammation, in addition to reducing fatigue, anxiety, depression, and being stronger. And I'll show you some of the data here. We talked about the effect of gut bacteria on the immune system, and that in both animal models of MS and in people with MS, if you look at their gut microbiome in people that exercise, to the extent that they're able to, of course, you have to do it within the confines of your abilities, you find increases in populations of bacteria that decrease inflammatory disease. So exercise really does have an intrinsic effect, not just on your muscles and bones, but on your gut. Very interesting observation. This will really persuade you to exercise. You'll walk out the door probably beginning already to exercise. Tissue destruction in the central nervous system results in a release of substances into the blood. And you can measure these particular substances. They're not unique to MS, but they've been used as a marker of disease activity in MS. And the two that have been used most widely are these neurofilament light chains, or NFL as they're called. They're released when axons break down. So if neurofilament light chains go up, you have more tissue destruction. The second one is GFAP, glial fibrillary acidic protein, which is released from astrocytes. So when they die, they release the GFAP. And you can measure these in the blood. And if they go up, there's more brain destruction. If they go down, that's a sign that things are quieting down. And a study was done in which two groups of individuals with MS, with relapsing MS, mild to moderate, EDSS under 4.5, so some disability, but not too much. They broke them up into two groups. One was given a home exercise program, stretch or do some things for 15 or 20 minutes. The other group was given the same program to do at home, but in addition, a high-intensity exercise where they were doing 60% of their aerobic capacity on a bike. So they were huffing and puffing. And then they looked at the blood levels of these indicators of brain destruction, NfL and GFAP, and the data are shown to you on the right. Exercise decreased tissue destruction in the central nervous system. Now, if that doesn't persuade you to exercise, I don't know what does, but I'm going to exercise more also. Now, let's move on then, talk about what everyone has been thinking about, SARS-CoV-2, the virus, and COVID-19, some basic facts about the virus. There are many coronaviruses, many of them. Most of them cause a common cold. So they've been around for a long time. They can infect many other species. Bats, you've heard about. They can infect mink. They had to destroy mink. They can go from animals to humans, from humans to animals. And like most other viruses, like all other viruses, they mutate as they multiply. Some viruses don't mutate very often. The influenza virus mutates so rapidly we have to have a shot every year. And the coronavirus, unfortunately, also mutates very rapidly. And the way to decrease its mutability is to prevent the virus from spreading, obviously. The virus attaches to a cell by binding to this receptor, ACE2 receptor. And it binds not with its entire body, but with a spike, and not even all of the spike, but a part of that spike, a series of proteins called the receptor binding domain. So just a small piece of the virus directly is necessary to attach to that receptor and enter the cell. And the vaccines that we're having now, they generate an immune response to the proteins of that receptor binding domain. Not the virus in itself, but just that little portion necessary for the virus to infect. So what about MS and COVID-19? Well, two basic facts, very, very important. Just having MS does not make you more susceptible to developing SARS infection. And just having MS does not mean you're going to have more severe disease. Having said that, however, there are indicators that if you have more severe disability from your MS, if you're older, if you have other comorbidities, we call them other diseases, diabetes, high blood pressure, then it does increase the risk of more severe disease. But just having MS per se does not. Now, of course, what about disease-modifying therapies? Very complex. One answer is not present for all individuals. They affect immune function. And obviously, if there are these high efficacy medications like alemtuzumab and cladribine, could they alter your ability to fight the virus? Now, the data are not in yet. I do not have any information showing that these two drugs make COVID-19 worse. But the potential is there. On the other hand, and I thought this was very interesting, again, no data, just conjecture, just hypothesis. People with very severe very severe COVID-19 have excessive activation of their immune system. They have what's called a cytokine storm. So people with very severe ICU intubation, COVID-19, have an overactivity of the immune system. The activity of the immune system actually becomes destructive. So it's theoretically possible that some of these disease-modifying therapies that modulate the immune system might actually have a protective effect against this cytokine storm, this overactive immune system. I don't know that for a fact, but at least it's something to think about. So you have MS, you're on a disease-modifying therapy. What should I do? Do I have to change anything? Well, the general consensus is you don't change anything just because you're on a disease-modifying therapy. Because having an attack, having a relapse, is a lot worse than the potential of having very severe COVID. In addition, there are certain medications that if you stop, you have what's called a disease rebound. It actually gets worse than it ever had been before. You don't understand why. You're obviously suppressing something. You take away that suppression and it rebounds beyond what it had been previously. Now, if you have COVID-19, however, if you are infected, then what should you do? Well, then it becomes very, very complicated. Then it obviously depends upon what you're taking, how long you've been on it, if you're getting multiple dosages, when did you have your last dose? It becomes more complicated. Now, there are some disease-modifying therapies like interferon beta or GA, glatiramer or acetate, that don't have any effect, and they should certainly be continued. You have to be aware of disease rebounds, as I mentioned to you, and if you're on a medication that can affect the course of COVID-19, you should think about maybe extending the interval between dosing to allow your immune system to recover and recuperate and perhaps allow you to be better protected. So there have been all kinds of algorithms that have been published. This is an algorithm here. As I said, it's very complex. Are you starting a disease-modifying therapy? Which one should you start? Well, you may want to think about a disease-modifying therapy that's effective, but that might not affect your responses to vaccines, for example. If you're already on a disease-modifying therapy, should it be continued? Well, if you get COVID-19, what are the implications of continuing on that medication? These are ways of addressing it, as are discussed in that algorithm. So there's not one answer that's going to fit everyone. It has to be extremely individualized. But what about vaccines now? You know, there are two major vaccines, mRNA vaccines, DNA vaccines. I personally feel that mRNA vaccines are a medical miracle. They're amazing. They're new. They have induced immune responses much better than has been seen with other vaccines, certainly the flu vaccine. What's the effectiveness of the flu vaccine? 60%. These have 90% efficacy in terms of keeping you from having severe disease. And they work by inducing immune responses to this receptor binding domain of the spike protein. So you're injected with the mRNA, the message goes into your cell makes these proteins, they're expressed on the cell surface, the immune system sees it, and you make neutralizing antibodies, but you also affect T cells. And what about DNA vaccines? A similar kind of thing. You take a virus, adenovirus, common cold virus, it's been modified so it doesn't multiply, and they put piece of DNA in it, that's the message for the RBD, receptor binding domain of the spike protein. Virus enters the cell, the DNA goes into your nucleus, the DNA is read, it makes messenger RNA, makes proteins, your immune system sees it, you make antibodies. So it's a similar kind of thing, just a little bit more convoluted. But it turns out that these vaccines induce not just antibodies, but also T cells. And T cells are necessary for B cells to make antibodies. There are two categories of T cells, so-called helper T cells. And then you have these killer cells, these CD8 cells, cytotoxic cells. Their function is to kill viral infected cells, which would, of course, decrease the risk of transmission. But obviously, as we all have learned, if you're going to change the immune system, you're going to affect the response to vaccines. And there's one category of medication that's particularly important in terms of altering the vaccine responsiveness. Some have no effect. As I mentioned to you, GA, interferon beta, have no effect on vaccine responsiveness. Some disease-modifying therapies may have an effect if they decrease numbers of lymphocytes. In your system, obviously, you need lymphocytes to have an effective response, and these are shown to you here, the S1P receptors, dimethyl fumarate. But if you're going to eliminate B cells, as is the primary function of these anti-B cell antibodies, which are shown to you here, there are four of them, you're going to affect the response to vaccines. And there have been two interesting papers that have now been published. This is one of them that looks at antibody responses to vaccine in people that have been on ocrelizumab. And on your right, you see the antibody responses. What's interesting, I thought, is that while most people on ocrelizumab did not make antibodies, some did. And if you look at the dots there, you see that some people on ocrelizumab actually made pretty good antibody responses, but most did not. So clearly, being on an anti-B cell antibody affected your response. Interestingly enough, the T cell response was not affected. If anything, it was a little bit higher. And this was further elaborated on in this other paper, which is now at the top of the screen, decreased levels of antibody, decreased numbers of helper T cells, but increased numbers of killer cells. Now, the key question is, are these sufficient to provide you with a protection against the virus? We don't know. Work in progress. So the immune system is compensating for lack of B cells after vaccination by making more T cells. We don't know if this is really adequate in terms of a protection. We don't know. So certainly if you're on an anti-B cell disease-modifying therapy, this is an important consideration. This just shows you again that the T cells are increased. Much, much higher there on the right, you see higher levels of CD8 cells. I don't expect you to be able to see this, but you have a chance to look at it later. So, can vaccination be harmful? Well, vaccines stimulate the immune system. They release inflammatory substances. They cause fever, muscle aching, fatigue, headache. Fever can make MS worse. That's a fact. We know this. But the data to show that vaccines actually induce MS, that cause MS, they're anecdotes, but there are no data really that show that, and there are no data to show that vaccination causes an attack of MS. If you have worsening symptoms due to fever, it's a pseudo-relapse. It lasts as long as you have the fever, and then symptoms get better. So there are no data to show that it makes MS intrinsically worse. The effects are short-lived. If you do have side effects, you shouldn't take anti-inflammatory drugs when you have the vaccine side effects, because you want to have inflammation. You want to make a good response. So avoid aspirin, ibuprofen, other non-steroidals. Obviously, don't take steroids. Take acetaminophen, Tylenol sort of medications. There are rare complications from vaccination. They are, yes. People have gotten very ill. You can have heart inflammation, pericarditis, myocarditis, blood clotting has been seen in the brains of younger women with the J&J vaccine. Rare. You have Guillain-Barré syndrome, nerve inflammation. Overall benefits greatly outweigh the risks. So what does all this mean? Well, if you start a disease-modifying therapy, you should choose one maybe that's effective but doesn't affect vaccine responses. I've talked about all of this in the past. If you're on a disease-modifying therapy, you may want to consider changing it. If it's at all possible, increase dosing intervals, all kinds of options. In any instance, though, don't make any decision without speaking to your healthcare provider, who hopefully is a person experienced in the complexities of all of these issues. So the bottom line for me is if you have MS, you should get vaccinated. Very, very important. So I'd like to stop at this point and acknowledge one of the sponsors of this excellent program. And after that, we'll have Dr. Shapiro come back up again to initiate a question and answer session. Thank you.
The Consortium of Multiple Sclerosis Centers and Catamount Medical Education would like to thank Greenwich Biosciences for their generous support of this program. This support has made it possible for us to provide this valuable education program for people living with MS and their care partners.
Am I on? No. Yeah, yes. Well, here's the deal, guys. We're going to do questions and answers. We're going to take them from the audience, and I have some that have been sent in. But during this time, there's food outside there, outside the doors. If you want to drift out and get some food and snacks and come back in, and you know what? You may have to go to the bathroom, too. And so if you do that, it's all right, too. We won't send a camera in with you to check on it to make sure. But we don't have a planned bathroom break, so to speak. I know that everybody wishes to have one, but in planning these kinds of conferences, we only have so much time and we have so much to tell, and we just thought we're just going to have to do it this way. So we don't send me notes saying, I didn't get to go to the bathroom. You can go to the bathroom during the question and answer. So there's some forms being put out. We have microphones, too. Or we can see your hands and things, and we'll go from there. So here comes a question already. That was fast.
Can you sure to put down who it's for?
Well, it could be for, I'll determine who it's for, but this one's for you. More interested in Dr. Birnbaum's mention of IL-17 as I have comorbidity with psoriatic arthritis, considering biologics to regulate. IL-17 versus IL-23, how does this relate to MS? Let me just tell you, I am so glad that's to Gary. turn your microphone.
If you have a comorbidity of another autoimmune disease, which presumably psoriatic arthritis is, you're going to be releasing cytokines all over the place, and one of the treatments for psoriatic arthritis, I believe, is anti-tumor necrosis factor therapy, which unfortunately makes MS worse. So there's always going to be a conflict between autoimmune diseases. A typical example, just to provide some context here, is that during pregnancy, MS relapses decrease very considerably to the point where they're oftentimes gone. But then several months after delivery, there's a flare of attacks even higher than they had been before. If you look at another autoimmune disease like lupus, pregnancy makes lupus worse. Autoimmune disease, similar dysregulation of the immune system, if you will, totally different kind of response to the changes that occur in a woman's body during pregnancy. Obviously, a woman's immune system changes when she's pregnant. She has a foreign body inside of her, and it can't be attacked, so the immune system has to be altered, modulated, changed in ways, in various ways we don't understand, but obviously different autoimmune diseases do different things. And it doesn't really relate to MS in the sense that it doesn't cause MS, but it could really provide a major therapeutic challenge to your healthcare provider addressing both of these autoimmune diseases in a way that doesn't make one better but the other potentially worse. And I'm not qualified to talk about treatments for psoriatic arthritis. I apologize. That's out of my comfort zone, as they say.
I don't think anybody is really comfortable in any of that. But combining these two different rheumatologic diseases, I had a patient who had multiple sclerosis that was very active, and she had scleroderma. And scleroderma is a different type of disease, not a good one. And she got treatment for her scleroderma at the University of Pittsburgh, and she treated her MS with me, and I treated her MS, and it went absolutely dormant, but the scleroderma took off like a rocket. It was very, very difficult. Yeah. We have a question.
I was just wondering, you talked about whether you have active inflammation, if your MS is more of an inflammatory stage. Well, how do you know? How do you know if you have more of an inflammatory type of MS going on versus, something else? And how does that affect your decision-making process for going on a medication?
Peter, why don't you take that?
Well, I think that one of the ways we can monitor your level of inflammation in your central nervous system is with your MRI scan. The new lesions on your MRI scan, especially if when you get an injection of gadolinium, if that shows enhancement, that argues that there's a new inflammatory lesion in your system. So that's one of the ways we can monitor inflammation occurring even if you're not having symptoms.
So it's really hard to really get an accurate amount of information on how much inflammation you have in anything, whether it's joints or your brain or whatever it happens to be. You should be aware that in these degenerative progressive phases of the disease, when we do autopsies and we look at the brains of these people, we always find inflammation. Even when we had no idea that it was there, there's always some areas of inflammation. So at this time, I don't know.
Actually, I would kind of like to amplify that. There are these new guidelines now for MRIs, and there's concern about if you inject a lot of gadolinium over the years, as we used to do, or we may still be doing, that it can accumulate in different body parts and just sort of hang out there for long periods of time. No evidence that it's toxic, but I think the new guidelines for MRI scans is you use gadolinium contrast enhancement for diagnosis. For subsequent MRI scans, which are important for assessing new inflammation, if you see a new lesion, it's by definition new inflammation. So you don't need contrast enhancement necessarily when you do your follow-up MRI scans in terms of diagnosing inflammation. The other are these new biomarkers that I talked about, these neurofilament light chains, which go up if you have inflammation and subside if you have decreased inflammation. So that becomes a tissue marker now. You can draw blood and you can say, gee, you know, in the absence of new lesions on your MRI scan, you can have rises in your neurofilament light chains, indicating that, yes, it's not detectable in MRI, but there's inflammation. So that's not generally available. It's an exam called a Simoa test. It's being validated now. The only reason it's not available is, as Dr. Shapiro pointed out, insurance companies are now not paying for it. But it will eventually be, and it can be done as a research procedure, in which case it will be paid for, and I think that's a very valuable adjunct. Not exclusive, but a valuable adjunct. So the MRI scan and serologic biomarkers of inflammation, I think, will be very, very valuable in terms of assessment.
From a practical standpoint, though, you're probably not going to be able to get all those tests, and so really you're going to be looked at clinically as to what you need to have. This one, I'm putting my tongue in my cheek, Patty. This one's for you. Has fingolimod been looked at as a treatment for COVID-19? No, that's everybody knows Patty, and that's not for her. To my knowledge, fingolimod has not been looked at as a treatment for COVID-19, and I don't know why it would be looked at as a treatment for COVID-19. It's not an antiviral. It's not even an immune drug. I mean, it's in some ways. So
I can address that in a...
Sure.
Different way. It's not been shown to be effective. A colleague of ours, Tony Reeder, had this very interesting paper recently published where he looked at the incidence of COVID-19 based upon, it's not the severity, just the infection rate, based upon the disease-modifying therapy. There were two categories of disease-modifying therapy. If you were on a B-cell depleter, ocrelizumab, ofatumumab, etc., you had an increased risk of becoming infected. If you were on interferon beta, you had a decreased risk of becoming infected. So obviously no one likes shots and all that other stuff going on with it, but interferon was the only medication that seemed to have a protective effect in terms of the development of COVID, not severity, just whether you get infected or not.
And that's not entirely surprising because
not surprising.
Interferons were originally described to interfere with viral replication, and so that makes some sense. This is for Gary because he's actually looked at this interestingly carefully. Is there data on stopping DMTs on postmenopausal women with stable
benign multiple sclerosis. What are your opinions on this approach? Let me just, before I hand it to him, just say, we talked about classification of multiple sclerosis, and I always like them, you know, we have a couple of bookends here of old people on here who have been around for a long time, and the classifications have changed a while, a lot over those years, and we used to talk about benign multiple sclerosis and relapsing remitting multiple sclerosis and chronic progressive multiple sclerosis. And the neurologists of today have forgotten that we used to have multiple sclerosis before we had drugs. And in fact, before we had drugs, some people with multiple sclerosis, for whatever reason, did well. And they really legitimately did well. I saw those people over 30 years, and they did well. And we coined a term, I don't like the term because it doesn't make sense, called benign multiple sclerosis. And in studies, 20% of people without any drugs did well. We just didn't know who they were, so we don't, up front. We had to wait the 20, 30 years to figure that out. A lot of the modern neurologists will say, well, yeah, they're all demented if you really study them, but they're not, I can tell you that. They're, for whatever reason, they did well. But that, so there is that issue that some people will do well and they're stable, and what about stopping DMTs on postmenopausal women or men who are older, for that matter?
Okay, well, you know, I don't like the term benign MS either, because just being diagnosed with MS is scary. So the psychological aspects of having a diagnosis of MS is hardly benign, and I don't like the term. But there are people who have MS, as I said, for decades, who can still run marathons. So in terms of stopping disease-modifying therapy, I kind of alluded to that in my talk. The older you get, the less effective the disease-modifying therapies are. The older you get, the more likely you are to have toxicity from the disease-modifying therapies because of this aging phenomenon and immunosenescence. So I actually published a paper in the International Journal of MS Care, which is the journal of CMSC, about, I don't know, 2 or 3 years ago, on stopping disease-modifying therapy. It was a prospective study, not randomized. So there is now an ongoing randomized trial in which people with inactive disease, what do I mean by inactive? No acute inflammation. On MRI scan, their biomarkers are, as I said, NFL levels are low, and they're randomized. You stop disease-modifying therapy, you continue disease-modifying therapy. So this wasn't randomized. In my practice, I would ask a person, do you want to stop disease-modifying therapy? I think it's a consideration. You haven't had any relapses, you're over 55 or over 60, your MRI has been stable, your exam's been maybe progressive but not radically changing. What do you think about stopping disease-modifying therapy? If they said no, I said, okay. If they said yes, I followed them. I had about 100 patients in whom I stopped disease-modifying therapy with those categories. No active disease, older in age, in their seventh decade and up, 90% did well. 10% had an acute re-flare of their disease within the first year. So if things didn't happen within that first year after stopping disease-modifying therapy, it didn't subsequently happen. So yes, you can stop disease-modifying therapy. It can be done safely without having a recrudescence of acute inflammatory disease, but it has to be done with careful observation to be sure that indeed something new does not appear with MRI scan, with exam, and maybe even with the serum biomarkers that I talked about. Yes, it can be stopped, but the definitive answer will come after this randomized trial. I forget the name of it. Do you remember the name of the trial? I don't remember. And anyway, it's being done by John Corboy, or it's being run by John Corboy in Colorado. And this will really provide us with the answer. But yes, I think it can be stopped.
We have
a certain condition.
Question with a microphone somewhere around.
Is it on? Hey, this is for Patty. Patty, when I exercise, produce adrenaline, am I right? To a point?
Say that again, I didn't hear.
When he exercises, it produces adrenaline.
Okay.
Yes, okay. Is there any way of bottling that? Because when I exercise, I feel great. But when I stop, that's when I, you know, go back to MS.
So there is a right way to exercise. So exercise should make you feel good, right? That's what we want. But you have to do it in a very smart way and very kind of approach it very logistically. If you're feeling well while you're exercising and then you kind of stop and then you kind of bottom out and you don't feel as well as when you first started, or you have a long recovery period, it could mean several things. One, you overheated when you exercised, and so you're paying the price of that heat sensitivity that you have. It could mean that you just approached it at a little bit too hard, too much. So an intermittent exercise philosophy, so where you start intermittently interspersing small rest breaks during your entire exercise program, so you don't basically empty out the cup of energy that you have and that has to kind of regroup there. So how you do it might be really more important than bottling that adrenaline that you feel. We do get that high from it, though, Jeff. We do really have that feeling of well-being from it, and that's a good thing, but that might be driving you to maybe continue beyond a little bit more than what you should be doing for your current functioning. So kind of taking a closer look at that, or meeting with a physical therapist who can give you some advice on that.
We only have a couple more minutes, so I'm just going to rapidly does colonoscopy prep kill off the gut biome? And the answer to that is no. It may alter it transiently, but it doesn't kill it off. How do you feel about mixing and matching COVID vaccines? Well, this is obviously a hot topic today, J&J and Moderna. The FDA has said that mixing and matching is appropriate and sometimes even better for getting an immune response. You need to talk to your own doctor about that. But I think it's a reasonable thing to talk about and to potentially do. And then the last question, which I'll throw over to Peter, because Gary will talk too long if I send it to him. It's, do you recommend probiotics to help the gut biome or other changes that can help?
I think generally probiotics have no risk, and there may be some benefit with regulating your bowel function. Patients with MS often have constipation. By taking a probiotic, that can help your bowel function, make you a little bit more regular. So I think there's no harm, and it's probably something that might be of benefit.
And then the last question is just that was handed here is, can progressive MS be determined only by increased cognitive problems, or do physical symptoms need to increase too? And really, it's not one or the other. It's whatever it happens to be in an individual that is progressing without any relapses. And it's not science entirely. It's a little bit of art in determining that, because remember, it's all kind of MS. It's not, there's no black and white determination. Suddenly you go from one to the other, or whatever it happens to be. And so with that, before our next presenter, Dr. Peter Waite, comes up, let's recognize our next supporter.
The Consortium of Multiple Sclerosis Centers and Catamount Medical Education would like to thank Mallinckrodt Pharmaceuticals for their generous support of this program. This support has made it possible for us to provide this valuable education program for people living with MS and their care partners.
Good afternoon. Is my microphone on?
Says it is. Oh, there it is. I'd like to thank the consortium for asking us to speak at this meeting and for putting together this patient program today. This is a picture. My wife and I were in on her 20th wedding anniversary in Hawaii, and I took this picture there. She invited me to go with her. It was very nice of her. So originally, this was the title of my talk, Coming of Age with Multiple Sclerosis, Personal and Professional Perspectives. And then they changed the title of the talk. I usually give this talk, and it's kind of a surprise about my history. But they changed the talk to My Journey with Multiple Sclerosis. So the cat's kind of out of the bag. I've had multiple sclerosis since 1980. So what we'll do today is talk about my journey with multiple sclerosis through the years. So what I've learned about multiple sclerosis and multiple sclerosis care starting in 1975 up until this year. When I was a college freshman in 1975, I lost the vision in my right eye. It hurt to look to the side, and I lost most of my depth perception. And I was diagnosed with idiopathic optic neuritis. Everybody knows what idiopathic stands for, right? The idiots don't know the cause. So the treatment back then, where Andy went through all this, was rest. My vision recovered somewhat. I never recovered my depth perception. I lost my color vision. People with optic neuritis, if you check looking at something red, the eye with optic neuritis doesn't see red quite as brightly. So I wasn't able to play baseball anymore because I had no depth perception. My goal was to play baseball until I couldn't anymore and then be a high school baseball coach. So I had to go to Plan B. Plan B was to transfer to a college where I could get into pre-med program, to get into medical school, to try to find out what happened to me. This is a CT scan of my brain that I had in 1975. You can see up in the corner it says October 1975. CT scans were just discovered that year. There was one in the entire city of Boston. The doctor I saw knew someone who knew somebody. So I had a CT scan because they thought I had a tumor in my eye. That's why I'd lost my vision. This comes up in my life a little later on. So in the second year of medical school, during the neuroscience course, I developed double vision, trouble reading, trouble driving, have what they call intranuclear ophthalmoplegia. If you want to look to your left, the left eye goes out and the right eye goes in. They're connected by a little wire with myelin on it. If that wire is disconnected, this eye goes out, this one stays still, and this one shakes. It's a very common symptom of multiple sclerosis. So now I've had two attacks, my optic neuritis and now the intranuclear ophthalmoplegia, at two different places at two different times. So that makes the diagnosis of multiple sclerosis. So I diagnosed myself with multiple sclerosis in medical school in 1980. So I had a good recovery of my vision, and I had my answer, multiple sclerosis. So I said, okay, now I can quit medical school. I went to medical school to find out what went wrong with me. But my father was a heart chest surgeon. He urged me to continue. So I stayed in medical school. At the end of graduated from medical school, now I had to decide what I wanted to do. First of all, I really didn't want to be a doctor, but I finished medical school, I might as well try. So I thought I'd be a neurosurgeon, but I didn't want to go through all the training and have my hand have an MS attack. So that's the only thing in my life that I haven't done because of MS. So the next thing I thought I'd do was eye doctor, be an ophthalmologist. But it wouldn't let me match for my residency because I had bad eyes. The residency director said, we have 100 candidates, we have 4 slots, we can eliminate you because you have bad eyes. That was back in the day before they had ADA and things like that. So then I did internal medicine because I had to do something. So I did 3 years of internal medicine and I really didn't enjoy it much. The people I minded least getting woken up for when I was on call were neurology patients. So I figured maybe I could do that. While I was an internal medicine resident, I had another bad MS attack. My right leg became paralyzed, my right arm became heavy and weak. This is an exacerbation of MS, everybody's had them. Treatment again was rest. 6 weeks I couldn't work, it took that long for my leg to recover. It got pretty much all better, and I went back to work. I finished internal medicine, and again, I decided, well, maybe I could do neurology because I don't mind seeing neurology patients. So I did 3 years of neurology training at Georgetown. It turns out I liked doing neurology, but I didn't like seeing MS patients. This is 1985. There's no treatments. I didn't want to see my future. Now, we've talked about MS being a demyelinating disease, so that's the wiring in the brain. So the brain cells are what seizures have come from. So during the neurology residency, I had another episode of left leg weakness, limping significantly. Another exacerbation of MS. Solumedrol, 5 days in the emergency room for 4 hours, and had my first MRI scan. My leg got better. Solumedrol makes you better quicker. So I only missed 3 days of work. So this is a big change from the previous attack in which I was out for 6 weeks. So that's an improvement. So again, I'd had my first MRI scans. So we'll talk about MRI scans. These are now some examples of what MRI scans are. And there's lots of different pictures we take. We don't just take one picture like the CAT scan or like a chest X-ray. They take T2 scans, and they show all of the pathology, and spinal fluid is white. That's that butterfly in the middle of the scan, that spinal fluid. All the water in your brain shows up in addition to the inflammation. So you can do what's called a flare scan. That subtracts out the water and just leaves the inflammation. You can see the white stuff on the edges, but now those black holes in the middle are where the spinal fluid would have been. So that's a better scan to see inflammation. Then you can do a T1 scan. That's anatomy. T2 is pathology, T1 is anatomy. So if you have structural damage, you'll see it on a T1 scan. You can see on the scan some of those holes. I don't have a pointer. And so those are permanent injuries. And then you can do, we talked about the gadolinium. That's that injection of dye. It floats around in your veins, and it leaks across the brain blood vessel into areas of inflammation. Gadolinium, Randy talked about, and Dr. Baumgartner, can accumulate in your brain. I've had a lot of MRI scans, and I have a lot of gadolinium probably in my brain. Now, it still works fairly well. I think what gadolinium is like armorizing the Humvees. It's hardened my brain. It's actually really good. My brain is now like made out of metal. I can take a hit now because of all that. But the gadolinium can show new areas of inflammation. So now we'll look at my MRI scan. This is a flare scan from the top, and you can see those white spots. Those are areas of inflammation in my brain. A white spot initially can light up with the gadolinium, then it may remain a white spot or it may degenerate into a black hole. Another picture a little lower down, you can see those are the ventricles. That's where spinal fluid is made. It's made in the center of your brain, and it leaks out over your spinal cord down along to your lower back. That's why we do spinal taps. We're looking for inflammation, and we're looking for those bands they've talked about. We're looking at the fluid in your brain, but it's the same fluid we take out of your lower back. That's why they do spinal taps, to look for inflammation. Now, this is a scan with that gadolinium. You can see there's little white lines. That's the blood flow, this gadolinium floating in the blood vessel. And you can see a couple of holes there. One's a little blacker than another. The blacker the hole, the more tissue damage. If one of those holes lit up with the gadolinium, it would be a new lesion. If it doesn't light up, those are the old scars of MS. Now, this is a picture from the side, and you can see three lesions. The one that looks like a thumb, the one looks like a shark fin, and the little one further back. On this scan, which is a flare scan, this is looking for inflammation. If we do a T1 scan, you can see that shark area is really a black hole. That's an area where there's no tissue left. That's all damage. That's a permanent scar. That's what we're trying to prevent by using the disease-modifying therapies, because they decrease new spots, and they decrease the chance of a new spot turning into a black hole. So let's see. I don't know where the backup thing is. So 1988, I'd started to talk about this. I finished my neurology residency, and I really don't want to see people with MS. I'd rather just be myself. There was no treatments back then. Myelin is white matter, wiring. Seizures are gray matter, brain. So I went to Yale and did epilepsy training for 2 years. So I'd learn about how to treat seizure patients and not really have to see MS patients. This gets to 1990. My wife said, you've gone to 4 years of medical school. After 4 years of college, you've done 3 years of internal medicine training, you've done 3 years of neurology training, you've done 2 years of fellowship, you're 33 years old, get a job. You must know how to do something. So I found a job in Hartford, Connecticut, joining a neurology private practice. There was five group members of our practice, general neurology, no focus on multiple sclerosis, just seeing adult medical patients. Now, occasionally, one of the patients that would come through would be an MS patient, so I did accumulate some MS patients over time. 1996, my right leg never really recovered from that first exacerbation when I was a medical resident. If you can tell which is your bad leg, you know how you do that? Just stand up and look down. The good leg, the foot will point forward. The bad leg will turn out a little bit because the muscles that turn out are stronger than the muscles that turn in. So I'm always looking down and trying to do this. But that's one of the things you can see if things don't recover completely is that leg turned out a little bit. So again, we talked about fatigue, exertion in the hot weather makes you much your symptoms worse. So my wife said, you know, you talk to people on the phone, but you don't actually see doctors. I want you to go see a neurologist. So we have to do what she says. So went to see a neurologist, and he said, look, you have holes on your skin. You really should take a medication. Betacerin had been out. Copaxone came out. He said, why don't we put you on Copaxone? At that time, Randy talked about in his practice, they were doing physical therapy, neuro rehab. Most general neurologists in the 90s weren't doing any physical therapy recommendations. They were just treating you with medications. When I was training, I was told physical therapy might help you get better a little quicker, but it won't make you any better in the long run. It's just going to temporize things a little bit. So now I'm in private practice, 2006. Having spasms at my legs at night, disrupting the sleep of my wife. Either you can sleep in the same bed or go sleep in another bed, but your leg is jumping like crazy. So we went to see another MS specialist. That individual actually examined me. He found my right leg was spastic. That means stiff. When you hit you with the hammer, it jumps. The reflexes jump. You know how they do that scratch the bottom of your foot test? That's checking for what's called a Babinski sign. Your toes are supposed to go down when you're an adult. If that goes back up, that means there's some irritation in your brain or your spinal cord. My right hand was a little clumsy, again, from that old MS attack. So he left me on my same disease therapy, but he started some medications to control my symptoms. Medicines for the spasticity and medicines for restless leg syndrome. Lots of MS patients do have restless leg syndrome, and he recommended I get an MRI scan of my cervical spinal cord. Remember, that's about 10% of your central nervous system is your spinal cord. So this is now the MRI of my cervical spinal cord. You can see about halfway down in the middle of the gray tube, there's some white spots. So I have at least three lesions in my cervical spinal cord along with lesions in my brain. That's why I have jumpy reflexes. If I hit this leg, both of my legs jump. That's a sign of spasticity. So 2007, I'm in neurology and private practice, been in practice for, 17 years. Seeing adult patients, and I've accumulated about 160 MS patients. I found over time that sharing my personal history about MS with the patient and their family members does them some good. We get it at the same level. I understand MS a little bit better than some other neurologists. kind of creating our own support group together. Disease management, for the most part, still consisted of just taking various drugs. There wasn't a lot of recommendations for physical therapy. There might be some symptom management. And I began to speak to patient groups, including about my experiences. One of my mentors, a woman, Ellen Lottie, a neurologist in Massachusetts, had said to me, "Why don't you do a program with me and you be the patient?" And I said, "Well, I don't want to." And she said, "But that doesn't matter. I told you, you have to." And again, men don't have a chance in these kind of arguments. And so we did the program, and I had to present myself to people like I'm doing here. And it was the first time I'd ever talked my story to people, and I really didn't think it was going to be a good idea because I looked pretty good, and some of the people in the audience would be sicker. And I thought, if I were in the audience, I would wonder, why is he okay and I'm not? And I didn't want to subject the audience to that, and I didn't want to, but at the end of the program, just about everybody came up to me and thanked me because I gave them hope. I've been at this a long time. I've had trouble, but I'm still fighting the fight. And so that kind of changed my whole perspective of interacting more with groups like this. I was also on the National Amherst Society board. And then there was a bump in the road. In the spring of 2007, at my hospital, they got a new CT scan machine. Remember, I had that CT scan back in 1975. This scan, you could look at heart arteries, like an angiogram, but it wasn't a catheter and things. And in college, after I'd had my CT scan, I was a physics major, and I wrote a thesis on the physics of CAT scan machines. So the radiologist called and asked, "I need a volunteer." I said, "Sure, I wrote a paper on that 27 years ago." So I'm the first person ever to have this scan at the hospital where I work. It showed that one of my heart arteries was critically narrowed. I didn't believe it. It doesn't make any sense. I'm 50 years old at that time. I have no diabetes, no hypertension. No one in my family has ever had a heart attack or heart disease. My cholesterol is normal. I didn't believe the results at all. I told them it was a machine, stunk. So I had to go see a cardiologist. He said, "Well, just do a stress test, you know, the treadmill test." I usually work an elliptical machine for a half hour. I figure I'll set a record on this stupid stress test. Stress test had to stop at 2 minutes because my EKG looked like I was having a massive heart attack. Stop this thing. So he goes, "It's too late right now to cathy today. We'll cathy tomorrow morning." So I have to go home and explain this to the boss. My wife is a nurse anesthetist that works in the open heart surgery unit at Yale, and I'm coming home telling her, "I just failed a stress test and I have a half a cardiac catheterization in the morning." She goes, "First of all, why did you volunteer for that test? Two, don't ever not tell me something again." So the next day I had a cardiac catheterization. All of the arteries in my heart were severely blocked. I said, "What about stents?" They said, "You'd need 6. So the next day I had 5-vessel emergency bypass surgery. Probably definitely saved my life. So if I hadn't volunteered to have that test, because if I hadn't had a CAT scan in 1975 and wrote a paper on it in college, the other things that happened were the day of the test, the radiologist called and said, the first volunteer didn't show up, so I went because the volunteer didn't show up and my patient was late. So there's all these coincidences to have me have this test and then save my life. Someone said there was a lot of miracles that had to happen for you to survive this. Maybe God doesn't want you in heaven. It took a lot of work to keep you out of heaven. So now in 2007, in the summer, the Mandel MS Center is proposed as a comprehensive research and clinical center to treat people with MS where I practice. I was asked to be the medical director for neurology. They knew I had 160 MS patients. But they didn't know that I had MS. I'd spent my entire life, up until this point, trying to not treat MS patients. I just wanted to play baseball. I didn't want to be a doctor. Here I am. Now I'm going to be the director of the MS Center. Our center opened in the spring of 2008. Our model is for comprehensive care developed at one site. Mr. Mandel, he and his wife are very successful. They've donated a couple of $1 million to get the center going. And he used to have to fly all over the country seeing experts. He wanted everything on one site. So each patient at our center is seen by a provider. Then they see physical therapy, occupational therapy, and speech and language therapy as part of their initial evaluation. They may see a physiatrist for spasticity management. Other services we have are urologists on site, pharmacologists on site, social worker services on site, an infusion center, research, clinical trials. It really is one-stop shopping. It's the definition of what an MS patient wants for care. And it's designed to take care of me and Mr. Mandel. If it's good for us, then we have it done at our center. So all these things I'm talking about, I did to me first, thought they were of benefit, so then I'll let them do it to my MS patients. So these are just some pictures of our center. I came up with the columns. You want to have a nice entrance. Plus, when you go through the columns, you can have MS. When you go out of the columns, you can say, I don't have, you can go back into denial. It's a nice thing. That's check-in and check-out, the waiting room. That's our infusion center. That's one of our two gyms where you can work out there and be supervised by physical therapists. This is our research gym. This is a machine that tests balance. We'll talk a little bit later about a really bad MS attack I had about 5 years ago. That machine, see the little gray thing on the floor? That's a Wii machine. So the floor moves. All three of those walls move. That's why they have those straps. When they were testing me and I was having bad balance and my score was zero, I said, perfect. No, the physical therapist said, that's the worst score we've ever seen. We have two pools. And this is a part of our research. It's a robot system where you can take someone in a wheelchair, hook them into a robot, and have the machine move their legs and train them to walk again. Here's a picture of someone on the machine. This is all in one center. So now 2016, this is what I'm talking about. I had two exacerbations within 8 months. They talked about MS burning out or does it go away? 2016 is 41 years from my first symptom. So I don't think it goes away in everybody. As Dr. Bermgartner said, about 10% of people have exacerbations. I had very poor balance. If I reached forward, I would fall over. I didn't know I was bending over. I would bang my head into things all the time. Starting to use a cane. Thought it was kind of the end for my career for neurology. I took two doses of the high-dose steroids. They didn't make any difference. Very little chance for a meaningful remission. This had been going on for several months. Then you have to kind of listen to people. So my physical therapist said, you send people to physical therapy. Why don't you try some? I really never believed it worked. I would send people for it, but it makes you better quicker, but it doesn't make you better. And I've been at this for a while. I did 3 months of really aggressive physical therapy, 3 times a week, a couple hours at a time. Learning a new way to feel balance. You on these balance boards and these foam things. Now my balance is all in my feet. But I essentially completely recovered my balance. It really was a miracle. And so I was able to return to work. So it's more than just drugs for MS. The physical therapy, the occupational therapy, the medications are all very, very important in keeping you going. Underlying skeptic turned into a true believer. So changing subjects a little bit, what happens is patients always ask me, what medicines do I take? And so initially, remember when the first medicines came out, beta-seron and things, I wait and see. I treated myself with, used to say wait and see. I say aggressive observation. Sounds like you're doing something. It doesn't, it means wait and see. And then over time, I've taken various injections. I've taken infusion treatments, had anaphylaxis, almost died to one of them. Then I've tried various oral agents, had very rare side effects to those. Now I'm on other infusion treatments. So I've taken 9 different MS medicines over time, keep changing, trying to find the right one that works for me. Which medicines should you take? Well, I have 4 criteria that I use for patients. First is efficacy. That means how effective the medication is. Are you having any relapses? Are you having no MRI activity? Are you having no decline in physical or mental function? That's what they use that term, NIDA. If you're meeting NIDA, then I always tell people there's no NIDA to take another medication. Safety. Understanding the risks of the treatment, the risks versus the benefit. So first, is it effective? Then you have to understand the risks of the treatment. Then tolerability, can you put up with it? All those injections, I used to have refrigerators full of shots. They'd send them to me, I didn't want to take the shots, I'd just leave them in the refrigerator. And then compliance, as I said, did you take it? Are you going to remember to take a pill twice a day? So those are the 4 different topics that I use when I speak to a patient about trying to pick which of the various medicines we have is right for them. And you should have an informed discussion with your provider. It turns out now I'm a provider. I used to be a doctor. You used to be patients, now you're clients. Everything's changing, especially with electronic medical records and everything. So in summary, from 1980, when I was diagnosed, to 2021, it's been 41 years living with the diagnosis of multiple sclerosis. I'm currently the medical director for neurology at the Mandel MS Center. I'm not where I wanted to be, but where I'm working, where I'm very happy to be now. We've seen at our center more than 3,600 patients over 14 years. I'm working with a staff of 30 highly skilled professionals providing comprehensive care. It includes neurology providers, physical and occupational and speech and language therapists, physiatrists, urologists, infusion nurses, pharmacists, integrative medicine specialists, and administrative staff, all under one roof. This model is a model that we want to spread all over the country. This is the right way to take care of someone with MS. Everything you need under one roof. It's the goal that people should strive for. So 46 years later, here I am standing on this stage talking to you, starting out when I was a freshman in college trying to play baseball. It's been a long journey with many twists and turns. I ended up actually doing what I spent most of my life trying to avoid. It's been the most rewarding time of my career, helping others like myself dealing with multiple sclerosis. It's the right place for me. I enjoy helping my friends, my patients. Half the time, we're talking doctor to patient. The other time, it's patient to patient. Hope has turned into reality. Back when it started, and I'm lying in bed, and I can't move my leg for 4 weeks, I'm just hoping I'm going to get better. Or when my I was just hoping my vision would get better. Now we have medications where people are actually getting better. Some of the trials show that people actually improve. Using the word better is a whole new concept. I just saw a patient last week young lady, her mid-20s, kind of a very blunt affect to her, but very nice, but very blunt. And so she was seeing me for a second opinion. And so at the end of the appointment, I agreed she has MS. And so I asked her, how many people do you know with MS? And she goes, none. I said, well, nice to meet you. I have MS. She looks at me and goes, you have MS? And I said, yes. She goes, but you're old. And she pauses and goes, no, you're very old. I said, where's she going with this? She said, they told me I have MS. So I looked at books and pictures of people with MS. Old people with MS are in wheelchairs. So I told my husband, she had just been married, that we can't have any children because I'm going to be in a wheelchair. And I told my parents they need to live long so they can take care of me when I'm going to be in a wheelchair. And I said to her, I don't think so. We're doing much better with the medications. We can get you started on a medicine right away. I think it's very unlikely you're going to end up in a wheelchair. It's possible, but we're going to do everything we can to keep you going. And she looked at me and goes, so you're saying that I could have a baby? And I said, yes. And her whole smile, her world changed. Because everybody remembers the day someone told them they had MS. And it was like, my life is over. Nowadays, with all the treatments we have, the hope has turned into reality with this in this lady. Now, there was a double-edged sword to this meeting, of course. This is all nice, and I gave her hope. But at the same time, I just turned 65 the week before, last 2 weeks ago. So the night before this appointment, I'm online for 2.5 hours because my wife told me to sign up for Medicare. And I can't figure out how to do it. And a week before, I'd gotten my haircut, and the whole floor is covered with gray hair. So now I'm 65. I can't figure out with Medicare. I have gray hair. And this lady's telling me I'm very, very old. And I said, yeah, I think she's probably right. And the Boston Red Sox have won the World Series 4 times during my career. So that's the happy ending to the story. So this is a picture when I was much younger at Fenway Park. That's Roger Clemens, Dwight Evans, Ellis Burks, Wade Boggs. And there was a cutout, just shoulders. And there was a lot of little kids lined up. And then me, and then a lot more little kids. To get this picture taken, I had to actually kneel down so that my head would fit onto the shoulders. And my wife said, you know, you're smiling more in that picture than in any of our wedding pictures. And I said, is that a question? So this is the team I wanted to play for. But this is the team I play for at my MS Center. So I'd like to thank you for listening. I hope you got a little bit out of the story. And again, my message to everybody is please take your medications because I have to take mine too.
Multiple sclerosis is a journey that requires patience, determination, and resilience. Not everyone's MS journey is the same. Some have been on their journey for a while. Some are hopeful about their future journeys. Adventures they'll have along the way. With the love and support of friends, family, and care teams. Living with MS is a journey that will make us stronger.
Yeah.
Yes. Would you give yourselves a hand for that beautiful video? We want to say thank you so much to those of you who shared your stories with us and sent them in. But also today, as I was walking around and getting to meet some of you shared your stories with me as well. And I just thank you, really. You are our heroes. We thank you for joining us here today. And I have another fun activity to do with you. And we're actually going to be talking about some other MS heroes. So if you would take your cell phones out and your devices for another Poll Everywhere activity, I'm just going to give you a moment to do that. Okay. Well, this game is called Celebrity Picks, and we are going to start off with this first slide that you can see. I want you to click on the celebrity that you believe matches the statement. This celebrity, although diagnosed with MS at age 20, continued to pursue their acting career and has starred in over 20 television shows and over 15 movies. Is it Jamie Lynn Ziegler, Michael J. Fox, or Lady Gaga? Okay, I see some people responding. Give it a couple more seconds. I still see some responses coming in. You can see those. They kind of look like little map points that are popping up on the pictures on the screen. All right, I think most of you are right, if not all of you. It is the beautiful actress Jamie Lynn Ziegler. All right, here we go to our next one. Get ready. This celebrity posts a range of webisodes as well as blog posts and links to MS resources. The goal is for it to become the go-to resource for people who are recently diagnosed with MS or simply curious about the condition. So, is it Tom Cruise, Jack Osborne, or Janice Dean? Well, you guys are—you know your Hollywood gossip. Are you listening to the Hollywood Gossip podcast that's out there? It is famous TV personality Jack Osborne. Great job! All right, we're going to go to our next one. And our last one, actually. This celebrity aligned with the National MS Society and recently introduced their annual Climb to the Top fundraiser in New York City, where more than 1,000 people climbed 66 flights of stairs from the ground floor to the observation deck at Rockefeller Center. Is it Clay Walker, Janice Dean, or Ann Romney? All right. This one's a little more tricky, I see. Okay, I see a couple more responses coming in. All right, well, this is the television meteorologist, Janice Dean. Isn't that wonderful? I love to hear, again, the stories of what people are doing and the inspiration behind living with MS. And so again, I want to thank you for sharing your stories. We want to thank you for being here today. And at this time, I would like to welcome up Patty Bobrick to present our last presentation. Would you welcome her?
Thank you, everyone, for being here in person and virtually. I am in great gratitude for being here today for a lot of different reasons. I'm grateful to the course organizers, Catamount Medical Education, to our wonderful sponsors, and very honored to be on this distinguished panel of these awesome neurologists. But I'm also very grateful to be back in Orlando. Those of you who know me, I spent 26 plus years of my career at the Orlando Health MS Center. So this was coming home for me. I moved away about 2.5 years ago, and I moved to gorgeous Steamboat Springs, Colorado. You can't begrudge me that, I know. But this was really a coming home. So I'm also in gratitude for all the people that I see in the room that I know that you think that I was a part of your life, but what I want to tell you is that I'm grateful for everything that you taught me about MS because of your sharing, because of your openness, and because you allowed me into your life so I could learn more about MS. So my gratitude to you. I do want to call out Dr. Shapiro for something, though. I've known Randy for 20-plus years, and I hope that doesn't mean that that makes my exit in this world a little bit more expeditious. So, because Randy knows a lot of dead people. I don't want to add to that list. But I do want to tell a story because I'm so grateful to, you know, all of the neurologists on our panel who are, I see the value of rehab and the value of the comprehensive team. So many, many moons ago, 20 plus moons ago, I went to my first consortium of MS centers meeting. And, you know, I felt like I was one of the newbies to this conference, and I had to find kind of the people that I knew that spoke my language. So the very first lecture I went to was on spasticity, and Dr. Shapiro was giving it. And I was just sitting there kind of mesmerized because I thought, oh my gosh, he speaks my language. And it was so exciting. And he had brought his physical therapist and occupational therapist. And I thought, they speak my language, and it's the team approach. And it's because of all of those influences, too, that we were able to kind of bring that to this Orlando area and some of the services that you guys all have and have access to now was because of that. So my thanks to you. So my talk is on the stages of rehabilitation as MS progresses. But as I was thinking about that, I said, I really would like to change that. I really would like to call it Rehab Strategies to Live Your Best Life with MS, no matter where you are. Okay? So, and we're going to have that kind of theme throughout my talk today. Dr. Wade's so generous in sharing his story and being able to remember when you were first diagnosed. I've heard many of your stories about when you were first diagnosed. Some of them feel very tragic. Maybe some of you were just so shocked. Some of you were actually happy to have a name to what you were experiencing for so many years that was left unnamed, that you were just grateful that one, it had a name, and two, that it wasn't a terminal illness that was going to kill you in the next 3 months. And so that always brings up a lot of shock. It can feel very overwhelming. Where do you go? Sometimes you just have to check out. This can't be real. I'm in denial about this. And you have to start thinking about what's my future like? What does this mean for my family? And all of those questions that sometimes get raised and that worry and anxiety. But part of what I'm here to tell you today is that you have healthcare professionals that can be on that team with you that can help you down that path, down your journey of MS. So, what are your first steps? Okay, you were just diagnosed with MS. You have a neurologist. You obviously got the diagnosis. But there are other team members that are important for you in your overall recovery and an overall journey on this trajectory of MS. And so I'm a rehab professional, I'm going to say that you need to pick your rehab team. Traditionally, that's thought of as physical therapy, occupational therapy, speech therapy. And we are part of a bigger team, which you'll see. But how do you do that? I mean, you know, maybe you knew a physical therapist because you had rehab for a sprained ankle around, you know, 6 months ago or a year ago, but they don't really know anything about MS. So you have some really great resources. You know, if you spoke to your neurologist, asked for a recommendation, they know who in the community is doing MS care, MS rehab care. If you know anybody else with MS, you can ask them for a resource because that's where the intel is. Hey, I went to this person or that person and they really knew about MS and I really got good care there. There's a couple other bigger sources that you could go to. The Consortium of MS Centers actually offers a certification exam to allow you to have this distinction of being an MS certified specialist. So you have to have a certain number of years of experience, take a test. Yes, I took the test and thankfully it passed, so that you could carry that distinction of MS, MS certified specialist. And you could also go to the National MS Society's website. They have a program called Partners in Care, and they have Partners in Care Rehabilitation. So you can find some rehabilitation professionals in your area through that website. I also want to tell you that we're always looking for our newly graduated therapists to kind of come up and learn about MS. We're trying to bring them into the fold. And just because somebody might be newly graduated and not have years and years of experience, if they're willing to learn, if you're willing to teach them, if they're willing to kind of go to educational things, it's not bad to have a newer therapist, you know, even newly out of school. I never take insult to somebody who might say, listen, I'm thinking about coming to you, but I want to ask you a few questions before I come to you. How many patients of MS with MS have you seen? How long have you been practicing? What's your philosophy of care? I think that those are really smart things. So don't be afraid to ask those questions if you're interviewing somebody that's a potential physical therapist or any of your rehab team. I'm speaking more physical therapy because that's my profession, but the entire rehab team. So our rehab team is part of this larger multidisciplinary team, and I know it's a cliche, but I'm going to say it, it takes a village. There is no one person that can manage everything that you're faced with or potentially faced with in your MS. Now, this slide isn't meant to show you that each one of these persons are taking care of you 100% of the time. Some professionals will come in and out. You may be seeing a urologist, but you only need them for a short time and they come out of the picture. Maybe you need to see an orthopedist or an orthotist for some other issues, and they do their thing and they step out of the picture. But gathering that team and making sure that you have professionals that you're comfortable with, that understand MS, and that are looking out for your best care in the long run is really where the success lies. So here's a list of symptoms that are most commonly addressed by MS rehab therapists. It's not an all-inclusive list, and I want to try to take you through a few of these to show you that how team-based it is, what comprehensive care really should look like. So if you take a symptom such as weakness, most people think, well, usually I have weakness in my legs, so that's the physical therapist. But you could have weakness in your upper arm. One of the things I hear about all the time is, especially from the women that I see, you know, I'm great during the day, but I go and I try to blow dry my hair and I can hardly hold that hair dryer up to blow out my hair because my arms feel so weak. So the OT can come in there, and whether it's strengthening or some modifications for that. We don't often think necessarily weakness when it comes to speech pathology, but our swallowing muscles, our muscles of articulation that generate our voice, our muscles, so they also can get weak. So again, the whole team can be involved in any of these symptoms. Mobility is a big one. Mobility is usually thought of as walking, but mobility is bigger than that. Mobility is transferring in and out of a chair, up and down off the toilet, in and out of a car, up and down stairs, rolling around in bed. So again, the team, you know, can take on that and not just one professional at a time. Fatigue, it's pretty obvious that, you know, all the professionals are really involved in fatigue management. You know, I'd be teaching you exercises and exercising in a way that would minimize your fatigue. The OT might be teaching you energy management strategies and how to set up your house in the best possible way so you can minimize those energy expenditures. Fatigue might come in if you're eating a big meal, so you need the speech pathologist to kind of counsel you and to give you information about how to get through a meal so that you're not choking by the end of the meal because those muscles have fatigued. There's sensory changes, pain. Balance we're going to talk about a little bit more at the end because I think that that's a big thing. Dr. Wade really put that out there that, you know, falls are really so detrimental in MS. I mean, it can be really a game changer if somebody breaks their hip or has an injury, head injury, or breaks their shoulder. It can really put a lot of more impact or burden of care on the caregivers or just what you have to face in managing that now orthopedic injury. Cognition we'll talk a little bit more about too, and I really do want to highlight my speech and language pathology colleagues because you'll see that they get very underutilized. So what are the challenges that we face in MS rehab care? I wanted to start out by just saying that the philosophy of care of how we intervene with someone who has something like MS, a chronic illness, versus the traditional rehab model, which is usually thought of as orthopedic. It, you know, you'll get a prescription from the doc that'll say 3 times a week for 6 weeks, and then you've recovered from that injury, and then they say, bye, see ya, and then maybe if you saw them in the grocery store, if they live around you, you might see them again. But if you're dealing with a chronic illness, you really want this intermittent and ongoing care. So because MS is chronic, we're not doing just 3 times a week for 6 weeks and saying, bye, have a good life. We want to follow you over the trajectory of your life. And if you so choose, we'll be there, you know, for you along the path of that. Another challenge for rehab is that there's a variable course. And variable can be from day to day. It can be from hour to hour. So if I see you at 9 o'clock in the morning, you might be looking at me going, you know what, I'm really doing good right in this moment, but at 5 o'clock tonight, I'm gonna look totally different. And that's really important for your rehab team to really understand, and they should be asking you that. I usually write the time of day that I evaluate somebody down on my evaluation so that if I do a reevaluation, I try to do it at a similar time of day because I don't think that it's really fair if you have kind of that fatigue that progresses over the course of a day to evaluate you at 9 o'clock the first time and then evaluate you at 3 o'clock on your discharge. So that variable course kind of can throw a little monkey wrench into some plans. There are many, you are living with many invisible symptoms. I can't look around the room. I can't look at two people waiting in the lobby who are living with MS and say, oh, I can tell that that person has more fatigue than that person, or that person has more nerve pain than that person. You can't. There are so many invisible symptoms. So it's really important that if your rehab team isn't asking all those questions, that you're giving them the information so that we can get the full picture. Because you are living with many symptoms that you're not wearing on your sleeve, right? If you put a cast on, somebody goes, oh, you must have a broken leg. But nobody really sees your sensory changes. Nobody sees your bowel bladder issues. I think living with any chronic illness, there's a lot of anxiety that goes around with that, some worry. And that can really impact performance. If I have a lot of anxiety and a lot of worry, I may not be sleeping well at night, which will feed into my fatigue. I might be distracted because of that, so my work performance isn't as good. So we want to be able to address those issues and address them really early on. And this goes without saying, it's a general theme here, is that we lack ongoing insurance support for rehab services. So, you know, we have to look at what your benefits are and how we want to utilize them. And that should be a conversation right up front with your therapist. You know, you'll either have the front office tell you you have a benefit, you'll get 12 visits over the course of the year, whatever that might be. And you should sit down with your therapist and say, this is how I think we should all, you know, we should all be on the same page. This is how they're best utilized. A lot of times we'll do more visits up front to kind of get things going and then spread them out over a longer course. And of course, there's multiple problems. When you come in with a whole slew of issues, we want to be able to prioritize them. So kind of what are your goals? What do you want to work on first? Because we need to have that conversation, because if we don't, I may think, oh gosh, I want to work on stair climbing because you live in a two-story home, but maybe all you want to do is be able to transfer on the floor to play with your kids or your grandkids. So being able to kind of prioritizing what's important to you should be conversations right up front. So what is the goal of rehab? Well, improve, restore, or maintain functions essential to daily living. And years ago, that's where it ended. In probably the last 10 or 12 years, I've added on with a focus on wellness. And that goes back to the thought that you may have a diagnosis of MS, but you can still be healthy and well. And they don't have to, a diagnosis of MS doesn't make you necessarily sick, but that you can live a healthy and be well in that lifestyle. So let's talk just a little bit more about wellness. Traditionally, it was thought of being freedom from disease. The broader definition, though, and I'm going to read this because I think that it's important, a conscious, self-directed, and evolving process of achieving full potential. And the most important thing there for me is that term self-directed. You know, it has to come from you. You can't wait for somebody to provide good health and wellness to you. They can give you guidance, but it really comes from this internal locus that you make this decision that I'm going to make these changes. And wellness should always be positive and firm and affirming. Sometimes when I go to say, to talk to somebody, do some education on health and wellness, I see them going, oh, she's going to talk to me and she's going to wag her finger at me and say I shouldn't do this and shouldn't do that. Well, that's not very positive and affirming. You know, the goal of all of this is always that we want you to be successful. You know, we're here to give you information. We're here to give you support, help you with some strategies that would reach those goals. But ultimately, it's in your hands. What does that look like? Well, good, healthy living is as closely associated with lifestyle. We talked about nutrition here, and my term is you put garbage in your body, you're going to get garbage out, okay? I have people who come to me at 1 o'clock in the afternoon, and I say, hey, what did you have for breakfast and lunch today? They go, oh, at 8 o'clock in the morning, I had a donut and a cup of coffee. I'm set to go. And I'm like, not really. There's really, you don't have any fuel in your tank, and I'm going to be asking you to exercise and have really good muscle performance. You don't have anything there to kind of have that happen. Good hydration. I am really learning this now that I moved to Colorado. It's so dry there. Gosh, when I got here to Florida, my hair went but you can't drink enough sometimes in Colorado. So staying hydrated, you need well-hydrated muscles for them to work. And I know that there is a lot of concerns for folks who have bladder issues, that they don't want to drink a lot before they come to therapy. But I always say it up front, you need a bathroom break, we got it. There's always time for that. And I would rather have 2 bathroom breaks during a session than you not be well hydrated. proper weight control, exercise, which we're going to talk about a lot through this program, and then controlling the risk factors that we know are detrimental. Smoking, we know that you're a smoker, you're diagnosed a little bit earlier with MS, and your progression is a little bit worse. And then alcohol and drug abuse, not good for anybody. So one of the takeaway points is that your rehab should not be one size fits all. If somebody says, oh, here, I have a booklet, and they pass it around to everybody, and it says, everybody in this room, this is the perfect rehab plan for you, throw it in the garbage. Because everybody is individual, and everybody needs an individualized program. What one person needs is not what the other person needs. There might be a lot of similarities, but there's so much variability that you really need specific recommendations. And plus, you have your own personal goals. Maybe somebody wants to return to bike riding. Maybe somebody wants to return to walking on a trail. And maybe somebody wants to just be able to pedal an arm bike. Everybody is different. So the one-size-fits-all method does not work for this disease. So this was a talk about when does rehab go, you know, what are the touch points for rehab? And I picked out four. I picked out upon diagnosis, after an exacerbation, during times of stability, and if and when MS progresses. And I also included that you need to have these touch points at the right time, in the right place, with the right people, and getting the right care. So there's a lot of pieces that need to line up, but they can be managed. I'm gonna talk a little bit more too about during times of stability, because a lot of times people look at that and they go, well, I'm doing well, what do I need my rehab team there for? So we're gonna go through each one of these. So what can rehab do upon diagnosis? Well, you're establishing the relationship with your team. Not only are you getting to know me, but I'm getting to know you. And that's really, really important because, you know, if we're going to have this long-term relationship, I need to know what's important to you work-wise and home life-wise and recreationally, wise, not just, you know, your muscle strength and what your balance is. So we obtained some baseline information, and we're going to talk about that because baseline information becomes important upon diagnosis, is because many times when I don't see someone who came to me early, soon after diagnosis, they'll come to me much later and they'll say, you know, I'm having increased weakness in my ankles, but my ankles were always weak. Well, I don't know how weak they were to start with, so I don't have that comparison. So maybe they weren't that weak, and this is really just they're feeling the effects of it for some other reason, and they really haven't progressed in additional weakness. Patty is not losing her mind. I'm not losing my mind, and that provide education is on that slide twice because that's really, really key early on. I just had a gentleman that came into the clinic. I was really blessed to be working with another amazing neurologist who believes in early intervention for MS. This gentleman was diagnosed 4 days before he saw me. He just got his steroids, and he came in with his wife. And I could tell that they were pretty shell-shocked. But I was all ready to do my baseline information and do my evaluation. And what I did was I put that all aside, and we spent the entire hour having him just ask me questions. I said, what questions have been muddling around in your brain? What information do you need right in this moment? And then, you know, I was able to tell him, listen, I gave him 3 websites that I know are really reliable information on MS. Don't go on anybody's blog. Don't be reading anybody's, you know, Twitter stuff or whatever. So that you can get good, solid information. And that's important at the start of this. I advised him that, you know, take it in small doses. You don't have to read everything that there is on MS. You don't have to have every bit of information, but just read the sections that are applicable to you. And that's where Randy's book came in really handy for a lot of folks, is that you can read what's applicable to you in that book and you don't have to read it cover to cover. Symptom management strategies, we're going to try to put all of those symptoms, address them in a non-pharmaceutical rehab strategy pattern. We're not the prescribers, but we'll collaborate with your physicians. If you're on medicines for your symptom management strategies and they're not effective, we can give feedback to the physicians, and we do that all the time, particularly for spasticity management. There goes those exercise programs again, and behavioral and lifestyle changes. So right up the bat, we're kind of hitting you with a lot of information, a lot of strategies that we want you to take forward. We're getting more and more evidence about the benefit of exercise in a lot of different ways in MS. So we want to get you going. If you're not an exerciser already, we want to make sure that you are. I'm going to go over a few baseline outcome measures, just to name a few, so you're familiar with them or you know what to expect if you're going into PT eval. So there's something developed called the MS Functional Composite, and it was a way to kind of look at lower body function, upper body function, and then cognitive function, which we all deem really important in the management of MS. So the 25-foot walk test is the 25-foot walk test. You get to walk 25 feet, and your therapist will time you. And they may time you at your normal pace and then at a fast pace. So we have that information right up front. So if your walking speed has slowed down considerably, that would be something for us to address. Nine-hole peg test, really sharp name for this test because there's nine holes and nine pegs. And you put the nine holes and the nine pegs, pull them out, and you're being timed. But it's for fine motor coordination, so a measure of upper extremity function. The last test on that composite test, if anyone has had to go through it, I'm sorry. It's not a fun test. It's the paced auditory serial addition test. Two numbers are presented to you, say the numbers 1 and 3, so you say 4. And then another number is presented, say the number 2. Well, you add it to the last number that you heard, not the last number that you said. So the answer would be 5. And so then another number would be added on that. So you go through that whole thing. So it's a test of mental flexibility. It's a valid and reliable test in MS, but it sends patients out of the clinic crying. So there is an alternative test that we often use, mostly use now, and it's called the symbol digit modalities test. There is a grid of different symbols that are attached to numbers, and then you get this grid of just the symbols, and you have to apply the numbers to them. So a little less stressful, but equally good in giving us some information about your cognition. There's a whole slew of self-reported measures that your therapist might be asking you to do. Modified fatigue impact scale to try to get kind of a objective feel about what your fatigue is, because it's very subjective, right? It's like, you're tired. Well, how tired are you? I'm really tired. No, I'm really, really tired. That doesn't really give us the meat of it, and it's specific to you. So this particular questionnaire gives us some information about cognitive fatigue, physical fatigue, and psychosocial fatigue. There's a 12-item MS walking scale that we might ask you to take, the impact that any walking impairments have on your daily life. Patient health questionnaire, 9, PHQ-9, which is a depression screen, so trying to address those anxiety, mental health issues right up front, or track them over time. And the activity-specific balance confidence scale, which you get to tell me how confident you are not to fall in certain situations. Some of these certain situations I wouldn't want you to be in, like stepping on a stool and reaching into the second level of the cupboard. But my favorites are, when I lived in Orlando here, the last question on the test is, how confident are you that you're not going to fall on icy sidewalks? Which is 100% because we don't have icy sidewalks here. So I had to throw that question off. Well, now that I'm living in Colorado and I live in a small town, population's around 12,000, there's a question on the test that says, how confident are you that you're able to get on and off an escalator? Well, the town doesn't have an escalator, so I've had to throw those questions out. Sustained phonation is a really, really easy test, and it's just a test of respiratory support. And those of you who do it in the clinic, who have done it in the clinic with me, you know, it takes a little, you gotta have a little gumption to do it, but you go, you say, ah, as loud as you can, as low as you can, and for as long as you can. And we can time that. And it's just a very quick measure of how much respiratory support you have. And you'd be surprised, even early on in the disease, we're noticing a respiratory impairment there that we want to address. We don't want to wait till it becomes a big problem. So here's what I promised about exercise. There was a Hallmark study done in the 90s, and it was really exciting when it came out because we really didn't have any evidence. I mean, I knew in my bones that exercise was good for MS, and Dr. Shapiro knew that. And we finally had some evidence to say that if you do some aerobic training, you're going to be able to increase your aerobic capacity, that your triglycerides might go down, the skin fold thickness goes down in the study, that you generate more force with your muscles, and that there is really profound impacts on quality of life. You felt better about yourself, your anxiety and depression was less. So really a hallmark study. And the conclusions from this is that MS patients reap similar benefits from aerobic exercises as persons without MS. And that might not seem like a big deal now, but it was a big deal then. You know, we finally had something to say, listen, what we're doing is right. Because quite often before this time, you could be diagnosed with MS and they'd say, ugh, go home, live in a bubble, don't have any stress in your life, certainly don't exercise, don't go to the beach, don't go, and all of these blah, 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 blah. And I'm like, you felt very powerless, you know, that, well, what can I do? Well, basically nothing, go home and like I say, live in this bubble. So gratefully, we have evidence to say that that is not the case, that exercise is good. So I put this up, there's a lot of words on this slide and I'm gonna just summarize it for you. So they did another kind of literature review about exercise and MS. And PRT is progressive resistance exercise. So you're exercising with weights, you're exercising with bands, or maybe just exercising with the weight of your limb if that's where you're appropriate. And they looked at a bunch of studies. And people who did a progressive resistance training program increased their strength as well as increasing muscle fiber size, meaning your muscles look more toned. And they had more power generating from their muscles. All good things. Some additional things that they found that they really didn't expect is that this PRT, progressive resistance training, also improved balance and functional ability while at the same time decreasing their disability status. So wonderful news. Another part of that literature review looked at a specific type of exercise, high intensity interval training. And that's where you do something for a specified amount of time, really hard, okay, I'll go all out, and then there's a rest period, and then you do it again. And this could be aerobic training or it could be weight training, and I always think of it as, you know, shampooing your hair, shampoo, rinse, repeat, so that you're doing it over and over again. And they found that this type of exercise actually was as good as progressive resistance training. And in some ways, maybe even a little bit better, they saw benefits in as little as 3 weeks. And it makes sense because if you're exercising and you're fatiguing, that rest break is going to be key for you. You fill that cup of energy up again. So, you know, the conclusions from this study was that exercising is safe for people with MS. You don't have to worry about a relapse or an adverse event, and that you should be able to expect the same benefits of exercise training documented in the literature for non-MS people. So that's the reason to start exercising and start exercising early. So now you have your exercise program, you've met with your team, things that you're on an immunomodulating drug. things are going along really great, you're feeling good about where you're at, you're not seeing any progression, why would you see your rehab professional when your disease is stable? Well, I like to call them tune-ups, checking in. You check in with your physicians, right? You should be checking in with your rehab professionals. And you do that because you want to make sure that you're continuing to do the right things, okay? You might have an update in your exercise program. Maybe you got stronger and we need to up the ante there. Maybe we need to add a few more stretches. Maybe you're feeling like you could take on a little bit more in the aerobic area. So meeting with your team can kind of give you those ideas about how to progress. And then there's what I call putting out small fires. You know, a lot of times, changes in our body happen really subtly. And our bodies don't send us an email to say, hey, by the way, you have a teeny tiny bit of hip flexor weakness. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to make your leg swing out to the side. And then that's going to put extra strain on your hip and on your back. But you probably won't notice it for, oh, maybe 5 years or so. So just keep on doing it. Yeah, you don't get those kind of emails. But if you're reevaluated by your rehab team, we can pick up these subtleties and then put out that fire before they become more problematic. Instead of before you have back pain, before you start having degenerative changes in joints that weren't meant to have those kind of stresses and strains on. Of course, we're going to do continued symptom management strategies and education. And maybe at this time, you know, we're going to explore some other forms of health and wellness strategies. Maybe you've wanted to try a different form of exercise. Maybe you want to try Pilates or yoga. Maybe you need some more resources for nutrition. Or maybe you're still working on smoking cessation and that we need to give you more support in that area. So lots of good reasons to see your therapist, your rehab team, when the disease is stable. Tune-ups, I highly recommend them. I just want to clarify some terms, exacerbation versus pseudo-exacerbation. So an exacerbation is a new or significant increase in a current symptom that lasts longer than 24 to 48 hours in the absence of a fever or an infection. We know that heat is detrimental to MS. You have a fever, your MS symptoms are going to get worse. It is usually associated with central nervous system activity. So if you don't have a fever and you don't have an infection and there's not another reason for it, that's probably an exacerbation. You'll go to your physician. They'll work you up to confirm that. A pseudo-exacerbation is usually associated with those things like heat, humidity, fever, infection, body stressors. And your symptoms usually return to baseline once the cause is removed. And there's not associated CNS increase activity. So I bring that up because a lot of times people will come in to me and say, Patty, I'm having an exacerbation. And we need to do a really good triage on the rehab team if that's who you're seeing. Do you have any signs and symptoms of a bladder infection? No. Is your urine darker in color or stronger in smell? Because a lot of times sensory isn't always 100% and you don't have the same symptoms that you usually do with a bladder infection. So that might be a clue. I tell this story all the time. I had a gal who came in and her spasticity was off the charts. And I was like, wow, what happened? And she goes, I don't know. I think I'm having an exacerbation. And she had some visual impairments. And I talked to her. I talked to her about her bladder. Do you have a sinus infection, earache? Anything going on with dental work? Do you have an abscess? No. And she said in passing that she had a pedicure. So I don't know what, it was divine intervention, I guess. I said, let's take your shoes and socks off. Took her shoes and socks off, and she had this toe that was so grossly infected. And so she wasn't having an exacerbation. It was a pseudo-exacerbation from this terrible infection that she had in her toe. They cleared up the infection. Her spasticity went down to baseline. So, you know, it's not, if you have an increase in symptoms, you need a good investigator to make sure that it's not something else. After an exacerbation, though, we're really looking to that restoration, restore to previous levels of functioning. And we, you know, I have hospitalized versus non-hospitalized. Most people are not hospitalized for their exacerbations anymore. We manage it on an outpatient basis. But if you are hospitalized, therapy should intervene then. Maybe you're in inpatient rehab. Maybe you're going home and you need home health because it takes extraordinary means for you to get out of your house, or outpatient. And if you're getting corticosteroids, the timing of your rehab might be according to how you react to those. You know, some people have a lot of side effects, and sometimes I just wait till they're done with all their dosing and they're feeling a little bit better. What do? We reevaluate because we have that great baseline information, and I know where you started at. Do you have any new symptoms? Are there things that we need to now address that we didn't need to address before? But I think that the biggest thing lies in this safety and mobility, safety and swallowing. And this may be the time that we start to introduce some equipment or update some equipment that you might have. And it may only be temporary. If you're having a flare-up, you've had an exacerbation, and you're having trouble with your mobility, we might be prescribing a walker or a cane until you get stronger and you kind of regain what you've lost in that exacerbation. Certainly, we're going to be updating your exercise program, and certainly, we're going to be giving you more education. So I put this slide up here. You guys know this, you know, just the different forms that we now use the terminology for. So, because the next topic that I'm talking about is when MS progresses. So whether it's secondary progressive or primary progressive, it doesn't really matter to me, or in those periods where we can't identify that there's progression, but you know you're worsening symptom-wise, clinically, you're feeling worse. So when rehab progresses, you really want to continue with the team. You know, make sure that you're accessing all of those professionals. You know, you may at that time need to have your swallowing looked at a little bit closer if that had been affected, because aspiration pneumonia might be a big concern for you. Certainly, this care should be intermittent and ongoing. Again, it's not like a couple times and I'll see you. You know, you want to stay connected to your rehab team. You want to continue those good health habits, because I think that at this point, you feel pretty overwhelmed, or you know, there are a lot of things to take care of, maybe some new changes for you, new transitions, but you want to make sure that you're taking care of your general good health. So making sure you're going to your annual physical, making sure that you're going to the dentist, making sure that you get your well women checks, so that you don't ignore that health and wellness piece of that. This may be a time that you want to be a little bit more open to any technology that would improve your independence. There are a lot of things that are low cost, low tech, and things that are high tech. Dr. Wade showed you some beautiful pictures of some high tech equipment in the Mandel Center, which is awesome. But maybe what you need are just some low tech options. And I always, always, always recommend that you seek the best information from your healthcare team before you go shopping on the internet. I have a lot of folks that have closets full of stuff that they bought that just didn't work out and they spent a lot of money on. So what about exercising for people who have progression in their MS? So there's an emerging body of literature. We're doing a little bit better at looking at progressive MS and what benefits there are to exercise. And there is evidence to say that there's increase in cardiorespiratory and muscle fitness, benefits to fatigue management, and also quality of life outcomes. And these studies have looked at conventional exercise, which we usually think of strength training, balance training, stretching, all of that. They also looked at functional electrical stim, where you actually have electrical stim that augments or takes over for the muscle if it fatigues, in a cycling situation, and body weight support treadmill system. So we'll show you a few pictures of that. So this picture on the far left for you guys is a functional electrical stim coupled with cycling. So if your muscles are fatigued and you're unable to make that bicycle propel that bicycle through a revolution, the electrical stim kicks in and it activates the muscles that will do that for you. This is body weight, body weight support treadmill training, whereas if some of your weight can be supported through the harness system, then you're able to use your legs a little bit more freely and you don't have to be so concerned about a fall for your balance. And then this really kind of techie looking thing is called an Alter G. We actually have one of those in the clinic that I work in. You put on a pair of bike shorts with a big zipper around it. And then this kind of bubble thing here actually drops down. And you step into it, and then it pulls back up, and you get zippered into it. So it's an air chamber. Air is pumped into it. So you're supported by the air. There's buoyancy there, and you're walking on a treadmill. And there's also cameras that watch your feet for you. So say, for instance, I'm working with you on gait training, and I say, oh, watch that foot's turning out, or you're not lifting high enough. You know, a lot of times people have to look down at their foot to really understand where that foot is. Well, in this, we can establish a really nice feedback loop without looking down at your feet because you have this TV computer screen that's showing you where your feet are and you can make the corrections. So those are some high-tech stuff. Some low-tech stuff, just an arm bike. I mean, you can get a great workout for an arm bike on the tabletop. You can put that on the floor, get a great leg workout, or a recumbent bike is great. So, you know, just be open to some things that might be higher tech or low tech. It doesn't always have to cost a ton of money to be beneficial. So I need to talk about, too, at this point, about transitioning to using a mobility device or other adaptive equipment. And somebody gave me this quote a while back, and I think that it was really, really beneficial for even me kind of thinking about approaching introducing some equipment to my patients. By failing to prepare, you are preparing to fail. So I have to make sure I set up a good environment for you to be introduced to this equipment, because if I don't, then it's going to fail. You'll do it because I said so and not because you see the benefit or the utility of it for you or how it may increase your independence. If we can do a slow transition, that's what we always like to do. Let's try this in this situation. Let's see how you feel. If we do poor preparation, we're probably going to have a poor match. And of course, just avoid buying a lot of stuff on the internet. I can't tell you what a big issue that is. So when to consider a mobility device? Well, when your current symptoms limit your participation in your ADLs that are important to you, or that it's becoming unsafe, whether it's fatigue or weakness, decreased balance. I get a lot of feedback from my folks that say, well, if I have a cane, if I have a crutch, if I have a walker, it's this outward sign that I've given in to my MS. And if you can switch the perspective on that and think of it as a tool that actually improves your independence, gives you more safer mobility, then it really isn't giving in. It's a tool. You wouldn't try to pull out a nail out of a piece of wood without that funny thing on the back of the hammer, you know? It's just a tool, and it made you more successful to do it. So if you can think of it in that, that might reframe it a little bit for you. Different types of walkers that you could use, and some home modifications. You know, adding just a bench in the shower can make a huge difference in energy management and energy savings. Rearranging your closets so the stuff that you need to access all the time is on the bottom rungs. Or, you know, maybe you sit for work all day and it just really, you're stiff and you're sore by the end of the day. Having some of these elevating desks now can really be beneficial for you. I don't want to leave out my speech colleagues because they're a very, very important team member on the rehab team. I want to cite this kind of statistic for you. 40 to 70% of all individuals living with MS could benefit from speech and language services. Of that 40 to 70%, less than 10% are ever referred to speech and language. And you can see that they can have a huge impact on your quality of life. They can have a huge impact on, you know, voice, swallowing, cognition. So, you know, if you're not being referred for speech and language, you know, ask for that referral. Speech dysfunction, dysarthria, happens often. You might be getting decreased volume, particularly maybe at the end of the day, that you feel like, oh, gosh, my husband and my spouse asked me 10 times to repeat that, and I'm giving all I can. So there could be low volume, particularly if you're talking on the phone, somebody will be saying, what did you say? We're experiencing a lot of that these days with masks, and I'm constantly asking people to repeat themselves. There could be lack of clarity in your voice. It could be raspy, hoarse, nasally. There might be some hesitations. And the intervention, there are interventions, exercise that help to generate better speech patterns and greater volume. Posture is a huge thing. If I'm sitting like this and really all scrunched over, I'm not going to be able to get really good volume out. And then the respiratory support. Swallowing is another area where speech will step into, and the changes can occur for several reasons. It can be fatigue. You have poor sensory feedback, so the messages aren't getting to your brain in the right speed and the right intensity. You could have muscle weakness. Decreased neural drive, meaning you're just not getting that good speed of those nerve impulses to kind of manage the food and get it down the gullet. There are a couple of tests that the speech pathologist can do. Modified barium swallow study, which where they put barium in the food, and then they do video fluoroscopy. They can see it going down, see if there's anything that's aspirating or getting caught on the folds. And there's something a little bit new, the FEES, fiber optic endoscopic evaluation of swallowing. And the speech pathologist can actually do that in their office, and they have a flexible tube. The speech pathologist I work with in Steamboat just got trained in it. She says, Patty, let me do it on you. And I'm like, yeah, great, okay. So, well, it wasn't bad, really. But but it's a flexible tube that goes down your nose, and at the end of it is a little camera. So she can see everything that's going on with your vocal folds and the folds and your swallowing mechanisms. And you don't have to swallow all this barium and stuff. And it can be give you a little bit more information, because if she's giving you food, then she can see kind of when those muscles start to fatigue, when things start to fail. Lots of interventions, exercises, certainly positioning, strategies so that you eat your bigger meal earlier in the day, and maybe even some diet modifications. Maybe there are certain textures of the food that you don't do well with that you're prone to aspirate. So they can do all of that. Cognition. Cognition is huge, but you know, I really want to emphasize to people that, you know, the majority of cognitive changes in MS are mild. They deal with memory, attention, processing speed, executive thinking, visual spatial abilities, and verbal fluency. It's not like a dementia. You know, it's not like I'm not going to recognize who my family is. And I know that I have to say that a lot to my patients, because they think that they're going to be not being able to interact with their families throughout their lifetime, and it's just not true. So between speech and occupational therapy, they can do evaluations, develop strategies. It may be simple as managing a calendar. It might be as simple as putting your pills in a pill box so that you remember to take them at a specified time a day. You know, with iPhones and all the technology that we have, setting alarms as reminders. And certainly education. And last but not least, I want to talk just a minute on balance and falls. Falls are higher in MS patients. And they don't happen linearly. The more disability you have doesn't mean you're going to have more falls. In fact, most of the falls happen before you're even using an assistive device or have a great amount of ability. So the approach to assessing falls is that it has to be multidimensional. You want to be looking at vision and sensory and strength, because all of these things fall into balance and fall. But fear of falling can be a big factor in that. People who have had a fall and are fearful of falling actually have more falls. So thorough examination is really key to address it, and then work on balance strategies. So on your rehab journey, your rehab team is here to support and guide you. And I recommend that you become a frequent rehab, frequent flyer. Come see us often, even when the disease is stable, because we do have lots to offer. And I'd just like to empower you to be in charge of your own health and wellness, whether you have good balance in work, play, exercise. Make sure you're taking good care of yourself in all of those ways. And I thank you. Before Randy comes up here for our concluding remarks, we have one last video from our last sponsor.
The Consortium of Multiple Sclerosis Centers and Catamount Medical Education would like to thank Novartis for their generous support of this program. This support has made it possible for us to provide this valuable education program for people living with MS and their care partners.
Should be on. There we go. Fatigue is the single most common and the single most disabling symptom in multiple sclerosis. And I know at this time in the program, you are all fatigued. I know I am. I hope that you've all taken away something from this program. It's been a very diverse group of people talking to you. I think that it's been very complete in many, many ways, different from many programs. You know, in the old days, we used to have a lot of educational programs about multiple sclerosis. These days, we have a lot of programs about drugs. And so this one was designed to be somewhat different from that. Before we leave, I want to thank the Consortium of Multiple Sclerosis Centers for allowing us to put this on, and Catamount for putting this program on in such an efficient way. I'd like to give them some applause. They did such a great, great job. We have a drawing. I guess you all have tickets in some ways, and I get to choose to pick it out. If I pick my own number out, you'll know it's rigged a little bit, but how many do we have?
We have three.
Okay. We have three prizes. Are we going to show them ahead of time? Yeah, okay. I picked out the first one here. It is a TheraTemp Moist Heat Wrap, and it's number 139577. 139577.
I lost a count of you, so
I'll
just have to keep picking.
I'll keep going. It's probably somebody at home tuning in on the internet. How about number 139591?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yay, okay.
All right.
They had to be in person to win, actually. Here's this.
What's in it? Oh, this is a cooling hat. I would never wear it, but if you want to wear it, it's okay. Jeez. Okay. I can just see my wife giving this away some Christmas, yeah. 139583. 139583. Nobody wants to claim this one. Let's try again. Number 139586. 139586. Number 139571. Ah, I'm sorry. It's heavy.
Gift cards to the Van Gogh exhibit in Orlando.
Oh, this is the best one. So there's two, huh?
Yeah.
Are there two separate numbers or two? One person get one?
Oh. Nope. One person gets
It's both. This is the best one, maybe. It's a gift card for the Van Gogh exhibit in Orlando. Two vouchers. Looks like four tickets all told.
Oh, wait, are there two on each one?
Yeah.
Okay. So one drawing for each one.
Yeah, so we're going to give
two
away. 139578. 139578. This was just in Phoenix. I didn't get a chance to see it, but a lot of our neighbors saw it, thought it was wonderful. Nope.
139587. What's the likelihood of that being? 578 and then 587. Okay, one last one. This last one. And this is 139579. All right, guys. I know I can speak for the whole faculty. We all thank you very much for attending and appreciate your interest. Let's go home.